of the devil. And you're about to get a lot of information on the devices of the devil tonight because your speaker is an ex-Satanist high priest. He's going to expose the subtle devices used to lure people into witchcraft and into Satanism. And he says he can get a box about this big and he can walk through the average Christian's home and he will be able to fill that box up with occult and satanic things in your home that have been placed there that you didn't realize were satanic and occultic. He's going to give you his opinion about the evil behind things like Ouija boards, tarot cards, psychics, movies, video games, Teletubbies, and Pokemon. You're going to discover the evil behind the symbols that you see every day. Will you help me welcome Stephen Dollins?
Thank you. Can anybody hear me? Good. I lead praise and worship at our church back in Topeka, Kansas, and I've been told if the microphone ever went out, you could still hear me sing. I don't know if that's good or not, but I'm just happy to be here. And I'm really happy to see everybody here because that means I'm alive and well and my feet are back on the ground. I've flown so much in the last 2 months, I think they've got a plane probably with my name on it. But praise God. All right. How many here are excited to be with the Lord tonight? No, 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 no. How many here are excited to be with the Lord tonight?
Amen.
Amen. Okay. Now, most of the time when people in the occult, whatever facet of the occult they're in, whether it's witchcraft, Satanism, any of those facets, they try to justify it by saying that, well, it's okay because I'm not hurting anybody. In other words, I read people's palms and that's not hurting anybody. I look into people's tarot cards, but I'm not hurting anybody. And I read crystal balls, but that's not hurting anybody either. Well, the truth of it is yes, it is, because first person that's hurting is you. You're very important to the Lord. The second person that's hurting is the person you're putting those spells on. Because if you think that you're putting spells on people and hexes on people aren't hurting them, you got another thing coming. I hope everybody brought their sword with them tonight. Because if you didn't, I'll give you a little word of wisdom here. Never go anywhere without your sword because you don't know what kind of dragons you may have to slay. So it doesn't make any difference what I have to say about it. It's what God has to say about it. What we're going to do is we're going to go to Deuteronomy chapter 18, and we're going to see what the Lord has to say about it. Deuteronomy 18, and we're going to start with verse 9. Now, you need to understand that when God uses the word abomination, that is the closest word to hatred that you will find him use in Scripture. In other words, he detests that thing with his whole heart, almost to the point to where he can't even look on it. You see, God doesn't hate the sinner, he hates the sin. When I was blaspheming God and calling up demon spirits in a magic circle, he didn't hate me, he hated the sin that I was doing. He hated the sin of Satanism. So we're going to see what the Lord says are abominations to him. We're going to start with verse 9. It says, when thou art come into the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, thou shalt not learn to do after the abomination, there's that word, of those nations. There shall not be found among you any one that maketh his son or his daughter to pass through the fire. That's human sacrifice. Or that useth divination. What's divination? Fortune telling. You're looking into crystal balls, you're operating a Ouija board, you're having your tarot cards read, or you're calling 1-900-SIN hotline. Notice I didn't say psychic hotline, it's a sin hotline. And we'll talk about that later as to how that works. And then he says, or an observer of times. What's that? Astrology. Charting your destiny on the planets, the stars, the sun, the solar system. And then he goes on to say, or an enchanter. Now when you think of the word chant, you think of something that's said over and over again. In other words, it's something is spoken. But it doesn't have to be just spoken. How many know that your kids are usually bombarded by about 6,000 to 8,000 subliminal messages on those occult cartoons they turn to every Saturday morning? If you were to take a videotape and tape that whole Saturday morning program of those cartoons and run it back in slow motion later on, you'd see them, guaranteed. And also, an enchanter is someone who enchants you into doing something. In other words, they make it look real sweet to the point to where, you know, you just kind of lull you into it and kind of pull you into it by just saying, come on over here and taste this. And then by the time you've got it tasted, you get hungrier and hungrier to the point to where you've eaten so much, now you're into it, you can't get out of it. And then he goes on to say, or a witch. Now, a witch is traditionally, primarily, and exclusively a female practitioner of the old craft. Let me say that again. A witch is primarily, traditionally, and exclusively a female practitioner of the old craft. Very rarely are males even allowed into a witchcraft coven to even watch their activities. Then he goes on to say, or a charmer. Now, what's a charmer? Well, a lot of you ladies are sitting next to one. Amen? So, he goes on to say, a charmer. Now, a charmer can be something that kind of lulls you into it, and just it's almost like candy. Like you know, we all know how Satan just kind of throws things out there like candy, and then just, you know, here's a little bit, and it tastes good, and it tastes sweet. Keep coming for more, and you keep coming for more until a point to where you can't turn around and walk away from it. A charm can also be a symbol or a piece of jewelry. I'm going to show you some of those symbols tonight. Some of you ladies may have even been wearing it. Praise God, now you can get rid of it. Then he goes on to say, or a consulter with familiar spirits. What is a familiar spirit? Familiar spirit is a demon entity that is familiar with you intimately. When you are born again, in other words, when you give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, God puts you on a road and puts you on a path for you to walk. You are now assigned by Satan himself at least two, more than often than that, it's more than that, but at least two demonic spirits to be around you 24 hours a day, 365 days of the year, with one assignment. You know what that is? Get you off of that walk that God just put you on. And they do an excellent job of it in a lot of people. Let me give you an example. Person that's been in alcoholism, comes home intoxicated every night. Sometimes he even gets through the door and he falls down, or he gets in the door and he can't wait to get to where he can beat his wife or his child. Gets delivered of that. And now he says, I've been delivered of alcoholism. And he walks out in freedom. Now, guess who the first people he's going to meet? Old drinking buddies. That's not by coincidence. The other thing is, let's say you've got a person that's in drugs, and they've been shooting stuff in their veins for years. In fact, to the point to where their veins are almost collapsing. And he says, I've been delivered of drugs. Nope. Walks out the door, and guess who the people he's going to run into? People he used to get high with, maybe even the drug dealers. That's their assignment, is to put those people in your path so that he continually throws you off the road that God puts you on. Now you know why you, as a Christian, you sit there and you go, Lord, I just don't understand. I'm having all these battles in my life, and I'm supposed to be, you know, I'm supposed to be a child of yours, and I'm just continually battling this and that. It's because those spirits have been assigned to you. Look into the scripture where Paul said, I was given a messenger. I was given a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to buffet me. What did Paul do before he became a Christian? He tormented and killed God's people. So that messenger was sent to him to tell him day in and day out, 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, how can you serve God when you used to kill his people? That's how that works. Then he goes on, oh, by the way, let me say this. These are the spirits that you contact when you're trying to contact the spirit of Uncle Tom or Aunt Clara that have passed on into the never-never world. Okay? Let's see what God's word says. It says, it is appointed for one man to die, and after that, you just keep coming back. Is that right? Okay. Well, it is appointed once for man to die, and after that, you just continue to roam around as a spirit. No? It says what? Judgment. Oh, so there is no coming back. Gee, then who are we contacting? When their eyes roll up in their head and they're supposed to be talking. You know, it amazes me when these people that go to these seances, and that's where you have a medium where this person is supposed to be a contact, in contact with this never-never world, and one of the spirits from one of your family members have passed on into this world, and you try to contact them. And it amazes me because all of a sudden, you know, only Bill would have known that. It's amazing. Nope. The spirits that were around Bill that are familiar with him intimately knew that too. See, that's how psychic hotline works. I call it sin hotline. It's not a psychic hotline. If you look at the track record of psychics, it's terrible. You know, in the Old Testament, if you were a true prophet and you were given true knowledge, you were only 99% correct, you were stoned. You were stoned to death. But yet here we have 1-900 numbers, and it amazes me. You know, I used to watch on TV, they called the 1-900, and you could have your horoscope. I call them horoscopes, not horoscope. But you used to be able to read your horoscope, and they would tell you what is in the stars for you, planet in the stars for you. And now, praise God, you can call 1-900 number and get your tarot cards read over the phone. Isn't that amazing? And you know what really gets to me is that the testimonies that they give in these programs are mostly women. And do you know what they say? Oh, my psychic told me where to find my boyfriend, who he was with, and what they were doing. And wasn't that amazing? No. Who was in sin first? The psychic. She was in an abomination to the Lord. We just read that. The second person that was in sin was the boyfriend, straying away from the relationship. So now you have a demon that's around that boyfriend or possessing that boyfriend, influencing that boyfriend to do that act of sin. And now that demon is communicating back to the demon that's in the psychic. It's a demon hotline. Not a psychic hotline. You have two demons communicating back with each other what the other person is doing. That's how that works. And then he goes on to say, or a wizard. A wizard is a male practitioner of the black arts, black magic, also referred to as a warlock. So a witch is primarily and traditionally and exclusively a female. A wizard is a male practitioner, also referred to as warlock. And then he goes on to say, or a necromancer. Now, the necromancer is one who summons the spirits back from the dead, supposedly. They're the ones where their eyes roll up in their head, and all of a sudden you hear the voice of one of your dear loved ones that passed by and passed into the never-never land. You know, these spirits are so intimately familiar with them that now they can imitate them to the T. I mean, it's hard to distinguish that the person that you're talking to is really not the person that passed away. And then he goes on to say, and this is God, for all that do these things are, there's that word, an abomination unto the Lord, and because of these abominations, the Lord thy God doth drive them out from before thee. Thou shalt be perfect with the Lord thy God. I don't know about you, but I love the Word of God. I love the Word of God, because I'm telling you, when God reveals the truth, it's like one of those paper shades when you pull it down, you know, and all of a sudden you just kind of let it go, and it comes back up. You see a lot of eyes get opened up. And I tell you what, you can compromise with a lie, but you can't argue with the truth. And when God reveals the truth to you, I mean, it's almost like eyes just light up, and you see that. When I was born, I never knew my blood parents. The only thing I knew about my blood parents was that my father was a policeman, my mother was a nurse. And I'm not going to tell you my age, but I was born in the 50s. Okay, back in the late 50s. And at that time, it was very easy to adopt a child. You didn't have to go through all the paperwork and things that you go through now. It was very easy. All you had to do was know the doctor, and then the doctor would communicate with the hospital, and then, you know, if you'd already had your name in on this list, I mean, you got a baby. And my parents, bless their heart, I mean, I got adopted into a family that, I mean, it was definitely God's work doing it. My father, which was the world to me, he was professor of psychology and the head of the education department at Northwestern Oklahoma State University. And my mother, she had also been a teacher also. But the Lord showed me on down through the times after I got saved that, and by the way, I got saved on February 2nd, 1978. The Lord showed me after that there must have been some generational witchcraft in my family. The reason I say that is as a child, I had a regular, normal childhood except for one thing, and that was that I was able to make things happen to children that I wanted them to happen to them. Not big things, you know, just small things, like kids falling off their bicycle or falling down, scraping their knees, but it was when I wanted it to happen. I thought it was cool. I thought it was a gift. And I just played along with it. And you know, all the way down through, as I was growing up, I got fascinated with magic and the occult and with the art of witchcraft. Used to love The Wizard of Oz. Used to love it. I watched that thing every time it was on TV. And when I was smaller, I used to love horror movies. And I know there are some people out there that do still too, but I used to love horror movies. And my favorite one was Frankenstein, the werewolf, and Dracula. And the werewolf scared me to death. I mean, I was a little tyke. I had no hair on my body, but if I had it, it had been standing up, you know, by the time I got that. And I was one of those kids that, I mean, I loved to watch that thing at night and then click off the TV and hope to be in bed before the light in the TV went off, you know. And then you pull the covers up over your head and you just kind of barely breathe because you want to hear if there's anything outside the covers. You know, it was just a thrill. See, our kids love to be scared. You know, they'll tell you they don't, but they do. It's a rush. It's a rush. That's why people love it. That's why a lot of people go to those haunted houses, those so-called haunted houses that they set up on Halloween, you know, put on by people like the good people like the JCs and things like that. That's why they go. It's that rush. They love to be scared. And I used to love to watch those things and get really fascinated with those. And the more I started watching those, the more I got interested in witchcraft. And I started watching more and more shows on witchcraft and witches and, you know, things of the occult. And when I got to be a freshman in college, I went to the same college that my dad taught at. And I never do that. Never do that, because invariably you end up in their class and they use you for an example. Okay? My son there, you know, just one of those kind of things. And when I got in as a freshman in college, I decided that what I wanted to do is I wanted to follow in my father's footsteps, and I wanted to be a teacher too. And what I wanted to do was I wanted to teach either elementary level or high school level speech and English. And so that's what I set out to do. And my freshman year, at the end of my freshman semester, we were given an assignment. We had 5 months to do this in. We were supposed to, first of all, write an essay for English. And that's how you got your English grade. And then you were supposed to give that essay as a speech for your speech class, and that's how you got your speech grade. And so I said, what am I going to do this on? What in the world am I going to write on? I know. I'll prove that witchcraft and magic don't work. Because, you see, I'd watched this on TV to the point to where I was convinced that it was just on TV. You know, witches are just on TV. The good witch, the bad witch, they don't exist. And so I set out to prove that it didn't exist. And I did that in a small town in Oklahoma who has only one small library and a bookstore downtown. And the bookstore is actually the drugstore. So I went in there and I went to the library and I started looking for all kinds of books on witchcraft. Couldn't find them. How many know you can't find them because the witches get in there and steal them out of there? So you can't get a hold of their material. Same thing the Masonic Lodge does. Send the Masons in there, steal the books out of there, so you can't find out what they believe. So I said, well, I'll go over to the drugstore. Now, Alva, the town I came from, is a very small town. And I mean, it's one of those towns where everybody knows everybody, and everybody knows everybody else's business. And so I walked into that drugstore, and I real calmly said, do you have any books on witchcraft? He said, what? I said, do you have any books on witchcraft? He looked at me and said, do I need to call your mother? I said, no. So I nixed that idea, and I got out of there real quick. And I said, well, what I'm going to have to do is I'm going to have to write in these magazines, and I'm going to have to send off for these occult books. You know, in the back of those, some of those magazines you can send off, and you send in $10 or $15 or whatever it is, and they mail you a book. And I got about 20 of them, and I read them from cover to cover. And I thought, hey, I've got a lot of information right here. Then I thought, you know, if I'm going to give up there, this is good for the essay, but if I'm going to give up there and give a speech on this, I better be able to say that I know for a fact that it doesn't work, because I met some people that claimed to be witches, and I watched them, and nothing happened. So I said, okay, now I know what I have to do. I have to find a witch. Now, you know what it's like to walk on a college campus and you walk up to somebody and go, hey, are you a witch? You know, we had something there, but, you know. And I passed on down, and I was in the student center one day, and I played in a rock and roll band at that time. I played in rock and roll band since I was 13 years old, I recorded like 3 CDs with different groups. They never went anywhere except on my wall, you know, where I could look around and go, hey, I did that, you know. But one of those, and I was, at the time I was playing with a heavy metal band there at the college, and the drummer was from the East Coast. And we were sitting in the student center one day, and I had my hand in my hands, and I looked pretty depressed, and he looked over at me and he said, what's the matter? I said, I don't know, man. I said, I've got to find the information on this stuff. I've got several months to do this essay, and then I've got to give it as a speech, and I can't find any information. He said, what are you doing it on? I said, I'm setting out to prove that witchcraft and the occult don't work. He said, are you sure about that? I said, well, yeah, fairly sure. I mean, I haven't seen anything. I've been watching people, but I can't see anything. He said, I think I can help you out. And I said, how's that? I could introduce you to a couple. Oh, are they witches? No, but they know people. I said, cool. I'll be waiting. Sure enough, he introduced me to Kenny and Christy. Now, Kenny, he explained it to you. Kenny looks like somebody left over from the hippie days. I mean, he had the real long, scraggly hair and the unkept beard, and his eyes were glazed because he was on pot 24 hours a day. And his beautiful wife, Christy, who was a nice blonde flower child. I mean, she had the nice long dress and the sandals, and she had, you know, beads on her wrist and beads around it. Well, she was beady, you know. And so I got introduced to them, and I loved them. I loved them. I loved going over there to their house because Kenny and Christy are the first ones to introduce me to mescaline, LSD, belladonna, hashish, marijuana. I mean, everything that you wanted, it was right there. And you used to love to go over there and get high and sit in front of his stereo and listen to all these rock and roll records. And I was having so much fun that I almost forgot why I was there in the first place. And finally, I looked over at him and I said, I think I heard that you can help me out. And he said, what's that? And I said, I have got to find somebody that claims to be a witch. I mean, I don't care what it takes. I've got to find this person and talk to him and get information from him. He said, well, just a minute. He said, who referred you to me? And I said, Dave, the drummer. He went in and called Dave, just so he could confer that actually Dave did refer me. And he said, okay. He said, just a minute. And he went back in and he made another phone call. And 15 minutes later, he walked back in the room and said, it's all set. And I said, what's all set? He said, you're going to be asked to come to a meeting. You're going to receive a phone call. He said, you be ready to go when that phone call comes. Don't call me to try to find out when they're going to call. I don't know. But when they call, you better be ready to go. It's okay. I waited for a month for that call. And it came on a Thursday night. I had a big test Friday morning. Dad had just told me, you know, better get to bed, son. You know, you got a big test tomorrow. And I said, yeah, Dad, I'm going. 11:45, the phone rang. Got up and answered it. Lady on the other end identified herself as a woman named Alexandria. Said she was a priestess of a coven. She said, here's the address. Here's how to get there. Come now. I'm looking at my watch, and I'm sitting there. It's almost 12. It's almost midnight. She said, we know. Come now. And if you don't come now, you won't get another call. You won't hear from us again. I said, well, I got to get this information. So I hollered in at Dad, and I said, Dad, I said, I've got a good friend that's in trouble. Just broke up with his girlfriend, and he's, you know, talking crazy and stuff, and I got to go over there and talk to him. Dad said, okay, but be back early. Yeah, right. So I went over there, and I walked into this apartment, and here was Alexandria. I identified herself. She introduced herself, and she said she was glad to meet me. And I walked in, and I noticed that it was just a regular apartment, except that most of the women there were nude and semi-nude, and they were all sitting around in this white circle painted on the floor. And inside that circle was a five-pointed star, and on the candles lit at each point of that star. And they were inside that thing, and they were singing, and they were chanting, and they were humming, and, you know, I had no idea what the song was. I started humming along, so I didn't look out of place. You know, and they said, now, what we're going to do, we're going to sit you inside that circle, and don't get out of there. And we're going to send people back to you one at a time, and you ask them anything you want to ask them. But we sit you in that circle, don't get out. And I said, why is that? She said, because we've been charging the air with all of the spirits, and we've been really summoning up our deities, and you're an outsider. And if you get outside that circle, you may be subject to attack from whatever's still left over. I said, don't worry, I'm not going anywhere. So I got in there, and I sat down, and sure enough, they came back one at a time, and they sat in front of a candle, and I asked them everything I wanted to ask them. How do you cast a hex? How do you make a love potion? How do you do a love spell? How do you summon spirits? By the time I got done, which was 4 o'clock the next morning, I left there and I had a big notebook. And I knew then I was ready. So I got back to the house and I started reading through all the things that I'd been told. And I said, okay, I said, this is really great. But if I'm going to give a speech on this, I'm going to have to say that I actually tried these things and I know for a fact that they don't work. So I got my friends together and we started doing things out of there. All the things that they had told me, hexes, love spells, curses, everything we could think of. And you know what? Every last one of them worked. So then I'm thinking, hey, maybe I better change over a little bit here instead of proving that it doesn't work. Maybe I better set out to prove that it does work because I've already seen it. I gave my essay and I gave my speech, got an A+ on it, walked outside the classroom. 2 girls were waiting for me outside. Said, we've been watching you. We know that you have inborn powers. Now, I had no idea because I had never said anything to anybody about my childhood. Said, we know you have inborn powers. We can take those powers, we can generate them and make you into what we think is your destiny. I said, what's that? And she said, just come to this meeting. We're going to have a meeting next Friday night, midnight. You come. I said, okay. They gave me the address, wrote down the address, told me how to get there, a little map. And sure enough, on that Friday night, I drove over there, and it's in the Rissy district of our city. And, you know, come from a lower middle class, you don't go up in the Rissy district, you know, you don't even have any business up there. But we were driving around up in there, and all of a sudden, I turned the corner, and I recognized the house, and it was my old high school biology teacher. And I pulled up in the driveway, and I got out, and I went up to the door, and I thought, man, I've got the wrong house. Knocked on the door, and I was shocked when he answered the door. And he was dressed in a black robe, holding a black candle. And he said, I'm glad to meet you, Stephen. He said, come on in, we've been expecting you. And sure enough, my old high school biology teacher came out from the back. And I said, you too? He said, yes. And now, I was looking for the circle on the floor, so you can imagine I was pretty relieved when I didn't see any circles, you know, painted on the floor, and people were dressed. So I felt pretty much comfortable. The only difference was that on his wall, on the right-hand side, was a black cross hanging upside down. And then as you go back to the halls, on each side of the walls, there were pictures depicting of pictures of hell, like demons casting people off into hell flames with pitchforks, things like that. And I looked at him and I said, you're a devil worshiper. And he said, yes. He said, we know where the true power is. And I said, oh. And so he said, I want to introduce you to someone. Man came out of the back. He was about 6'2", thin, had a hood on his head, still in black robe, carrying another black candle. He walked out and introduced himself as Michael. And Michael said, glad to meet you. He said, we're very interested in you. He said, we've been watching you very carefully. In fact, we know things about you that you don't think we know. Now, that made me feel real comfortable. Then he looked at me and he said, we think you just may be the new blood we're looking for. Now, I want to tell you something. You're in a group of people that are holding black candles, they're dressed in black robes, and you know they worship the devil, and they look at you and tell you that you're the new blood they're looking for. First thing that goes through your mind is, oh my God, they want to sacrifice me. But that wasn't the case, and he must have read my mind because he said, no, that's not it. He said, our leader is going back to a grotto. Grotto, by the way, in witchcraft you have covens, and that's 13 young women. It could be older women. But 13 women, then you have a high priestess that rules over them. In Satanism, you have what's called grottos, and there are no certain number of men or women. It's just all mixed. Then you have a high priest and a high priestess that rules over them. And he said he was going back to take over a grotto on the West Coast, and they needed somebody to fill his place. And they thought I was the one that might be just in position for that. And he said, what we want you to do is we want you to continue to come to meetings. So I did for the next 6 months. And my high school biology teacher became my mentor. He taught me everything I needed to know. And by that time, I was really getting really into this. And I mean, the people made me feel so comfortable and so welcome. And so, I mean, they're just like, their hands and their arms were open. And you'd look over on a table and there'd be lines of cocaine. And there'd be mescaline. And there'd be heroin. I mean, everything that you could imagine would be on this table. And they said, if that's what you want, there it is. And they looked over here and they said, there was a line of women sitting on a couch. They said, if that's what you're into, he said, all you got to do is point out that woman, we'll send them back in the back. Well, being around Satanists, I didn't want to get high. And I'm real shy around women, so that didn't really, you know, that didn't really appeal to me. So I said, no, I'll just stand around and watch, see what you guys do. And so I did. And I picked up everything that they needed to tell me. And then one night they started talking about something about sacrifice. And I looked at them and I thought, no, I don't know about this. Because see, I was dragged to Sunday school, okay, as a child. I was one of those children that when they get out of the car, you see like two tracks go from the car all the way up to the porch of the church because they're trying to dig their heels into the ground, keep mom from pulling them along. And I knew about Jesus because I'd studied in Sunday school about Jesus and the little lambs and Jesus and the children and that sort of thing. But I didn't know who he was. I didn't know what he did. And at that time, I didn't know he did it for me. And so something inside said, no, these people are just not for you. And I turned around to walk away. This was the last part of 69. Turned around to walk away. And I'll never forget, Michael put his hand on my shoulder, turned me around, and with cold black eyes, he said, you'll be back. I said, I don't think so. September 1970, I was working on, after classes, I'd go over and work on stage sets for college plays. And I was up on the scaffold, and I was putting up lighting for a play getting ready to put on that weekend. And a young man came running through the door, and he said, hey, did you just hear the news? He said, some old man just got killed, hit and run. And I hollered down. I said, what? He said, yeah, I was just on the radio. He said, some old man was on his bicycle, and a guy hit him with a car and hit and run. They can't find him. They can't catch him. And now the first thing that went to my mind was, well, he deserved it. You know, I mean, some old man on a bicycle, he didn't need to be out there in the first place. Now, it never dawned on me that my dad, to relax after class, used to like to take his bicycle and the bird dogs and ride about a half a mile outside of town where he had friends that had a farm and they had a vegetable garden. And that's what he loved to do after class, to relax. And about 5 minutes later, I got a page, and it was one of Dad's good friends. And he says, we think you better come home because we think it's your dad. We can't find the bird dogs, and his bicycle's gone. Did you hear the news? And I said, yes, I did. He said, you better come home. We're just waiting for identification. So I got in my car, and I hurried home. When I got to the house, all the friends of the family and neighbors were all right around the house. And one of Dad's very, very good friends came up and gave me a big hug, and he said, we're praying it's not Joe, but we think it's your dad. We're just waiting. And sure enough, within 5 minutes, the highway patrol called back and identified positive that it was my dad that had been killed. The man that killed him and hit and run, he had just been released from a mental institution. He was coming back from seeing his lawyer on a sodomy case. He was drunk and going over 100 miles an hour, came off a bridge and hit my dad from behind as he was riding on a bicycle. Killed him instantly. After the funeral, good meaning people, all they could tell me was that it must have been God's will. God must have needed your dad for something really bad. God must have had something special in heaven. And you know what? That didn't comfort me. That made me extremely angry. And I said, if that's the kind of God that would take my dad off the earth like that, I don't want to have anything to do with him. And I turned around and announced that I was giving up any kind of church, you know, affiliation, that I didn't believe in that God. And I said, I know where the true power is. And I went back to those people and told them now I was ready to join. I had to fill out an application, they told me, and send it in to the Church of Satan in San Francisco, California. That's who this group was associated with, run by a man named Anton Zandor LaVey. This application is worse than a tax form. I mean, it's about 25, 30 pages, and they want to know everything about you, and I mean everything, even including your sexual preferences. You send this thing in, and they tell you to wait 4 to 6 weeks, and they give you a reply back as to whether or not you've been accepted or rejected from the church. I said, well, I'll just wait the 4 to 6 weeks. Mother decided that at the end of that week, we needed to go to Clarksville, Texas, to visit my grandmother, to get away from all this, to have a little break. Funeral was already over. We needed to relax. I said, okay. We got in the car and drove all the way down to the southern panhandle of Texas to a little town called Clarksville. Now, in Clarksville, about the biggest excitement is their movie theater. Okay, that's where everybody spends their time. And they have one movie theater, and they have just a small bookstore on the corner. And I went down there, and I said, well, I'm going to get out of here. I've heard all these people talking about Dad and how sad it is that he's gone, and I've got to get some air. So I went in the car and I went downtown. I went to the movie theater, and sure enough, it was a movie I'd seen about two or three times. So I decided I didn't want to go there. I said, I know, I'll get something to read. I went over to the little bookstore. And I went over to the bookstore and I walked in there, and I, you know, big selection. It's one of those round racks that you turn around, carousel racks. And I turned it around the first time, and there was nothing there but love stories and war stories and westerns. And I turned it around the second time and looked in every book in the rack, and it was love stories and war stories and westerns. And I thought, oh my gosh, this is going to be exciting. And I turned around the third time, and there was love stories and war stories. And right there on the middle rack, staring at me, was a black book. And it was the Satanic Bible by Anton Zandor LaVey. That hadn't been there the first two times I turned that rack around. I went up there and I said, do you have any more of these? Clerk said, we didn't even know we had that one. What is it? I said, never mind, sell it to me. I think I paid about $5 for it. Took it home, read it from cover to cover, even started trying to memorize things out of it. Went back and shared it with my girlfriend at the time. She said, oh, this is great because this is the way that I've believed all along. I said, well, cool. When I get to be a high priest, I'll bring you in and make you the high priestess. She said, well, that'd be good. So when I got back to Alva, sure enough, not a week had passed. There was a church letter in the mailbox, a reply from them. Not only had I been accepted into the church, I had also, through the referral of Michael and his group, been given the honor of being high priest. And that's what I did for the next 7.5 years. I led those people in Oklahoma. And I mean, we did everything. We summoned up demonic spirits to go out and do what we wanted them to do. You see, Satan, in Satanism, the Satanists don't actually do anything. You summon up the spirits to go out and do it for you. I got to tell you a story. I got to tell you this because if you're born again Christian, you're spirit filled. I mean, you need to know how powerful the name of Jesus is. You do. You need to know about the blood of Jesus Christ. We summoned up a spirit, and the reason we did that is one of the young witches came in, and she said, there's a lady down the street who's a Christian, and she's threatening to expose us, threatening to expose our group. And I said, well, we've got the police department, the sheriff's department. I mean, there's no problem there. She goes, no, you don't understand. She's going to tell my mother. I said, oh, we can't have that. She said, no, if she tells my mother, she said, my mother will make me quit. I said, oh, okay. Well, what do you want us to do? Well, let's just hurt her a little bit. Let's put a hex on her. Not a big one, just a little one. I said, oh, you mean send something after her just to make something happen to let her know we're there? She said, yes. Okay, we can do that. So what we did is we got in the circle and we summoned up a spirit named Astaroth. Now, this is supposed to be one of the hierarchy of the demons. And over in the side of the room, this orange cloud started appearing. And as it appeared, there started appearing a face out of that cloud. And guess what face it was? The Wolf Man. The thing that I'd been afraid of ever since I was a little kid. So I'm sitting there trying to make people think that, hey, I'm cool. You know, nothing wrong with me. And I didn't want to show fear in front of my people, you know, and my followers. So all of a sudden, this cloud started appearing. And we told it what we wanted it to do. We sent it off, and it was gone. We came out 5 minutes later, came out of the circle, everybody talking, having a good time. We were getting ready to break the meeting up. All of a sudden, this orange cloud started appearing in the side of the room again. And I looked at it and I said, oh, everybody back in the circle, quick. We got back in the circle and this cloud appeared again. This time, this thing was in a rage. I mean, it was angry. And it spoke to me just like I'm speaking to you tonight. I mean that audibly. And it said, don't you ever send me after a Christian again. And I'm telling you, I mean, that's the power. This woman must have had the blood of Jesus all over her. You know, must have had the blood of Jesus all over her. Must have even anointed her house or had protective angels outside or something, you know. I think that was probably my biggest turning point. Because I'm sitting there now thinking, wait a minute. We're supposed to be the ones in control. We're supposed to have all the power. And all of a sudden, here's a demon spirit telling us don't send it after Christians. What's going on? Anyway, one thing led to another. I ended up being... my mother actually ended up shipping me to Topeka, Kansas to live with my aunt and uncle because she thought that they could make me prim and proper and shape me up. And they tried, and I rebelled every step of the way. I was practicing things on my own even while living at their house. Praise God, my aunt and I have such a relationship now because, I mean, I look at her as being my second mother. She's done so much for me. But I rebelled, and I regret that, but I rebelled every step of the way. And then I said, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back and marry the high priestess so I'll have a reason to get out of here. You know, it's no fun to practice on your own. You need somebody to practice with. So I married her, brought her up to Topeka. We moved out, got our own apartment. We practiced on our own, never really got into a group again. We kind of just kept continuing to practice. And one thing led to another, and at one point, I mean, all my jobs were falling in, caving in. It was like I couldn't keep a job, and I said, what's going on here? And our house was about to be, the mortgage on it was about to be foreclosed. We were penniless. We were broke. I mean, we had nothing. And one morning, about 3 o'clock in the morning, I just decided that my wife had gone to bed, and I was sitting there in a chair, and I said, this is it. It's over. And I took out a gun, and I looked at it, and it had two bullets in the chamber, and I said, one of them will get. And I put it to my head, and I said, this is it. I'm going to glorify myself. Now, you need to understand there are three denominations of Satanism. The first denomination believes that if you're a good Satanist and you followed what he told you to do, that when you die, you get to be reborn in someone else and live your life all over again. It's like something else. The second denomination believes that if you were a good Satanist, when you die, hell is not a place where you go and you are burned in torment. It's whatever life, whatever sin in the flesh you enjoyed in this life, you get to enjoy it 1,000 times more whenever you get there. Okay? And the third denomination, which was the denomination that I was a member of, believed that the Battle of Armageddon, Satan was finally going to overthrow God, take his place on the throne, and if you were a good Satanist, you got to reign along with him. They're still waiting for that. Okay? And so I said, well, I'm going to glorify myself, I'm going to take myself out, and I'll be honored whenever I get there. And so I had the gun, and I was getting ready to put it to my head, and flashback started coming back, and I had a friend that I worked on night shift for about 3 years. I worked at a facility there in Topeka and for mentally retarded children. And I worked on a night shift with him for 3 years. And he had given me a book called The Satan Seller by Mike Warnke. And I read that book in 2 nights. I mean, I said, I couldn't put it down. I sat there and I read that book for 2 nights. And I thought, you know, all hell seems to be breaking loose in my life, but this guy got out. Now, I'm not going to become a Christian like he did. I said, but maybe at least I can get out of it. You see, Satan has a lie for everybody that's in the occult, and that is that once you're in, you can't get out. And so I read that book, and I started getting a little more hope, and even the friend that gave it to me had been in a group called the Brotherhood in Southern California, and they were really heavily into animal sacrifice, human sacrifice, and even the abduction of children. And he had gotten out through a group called Christ is the Answer as they were passing through Topeka one summer. And so I talked to him, and that night, or that morning, I said, I'm just going to call him and thank him for being my friend, because he was the only person that ever really tried to reach out to me. And I called him on the phone. The first time I couldn't get him, something told me to let the phone keep ringing. Sure enough, he picked the phone up. I said, I'm just getting ready to take myself out of this world, and I just wanted to thank you for being my friend. I said, but you know, it's real strange. I feel like there's an invisible hand reaching out to me, and this is my last chance. He said, what is it? He said, brother, you don't know how right you are. He started crying on the other end. He said, people have been praying for you for the last 7 years. In fact, while you were downstairs in your mother's house with your group of people summoning up demons, your mother was probably in her bedroom on her very knees praying for your soul. I said, huh. He said, has our friendship ever meant anything to you? And I said, oh, yeah, it's been the world. I mean, you've been my only friend. He said, then do me one favor. Put the gun down tonight. Don't do anything. I'm going to make a phone call. I'm going to set up a meeting for tomorrow morning. I've got two friends. I said, what kind of friends? Well, they're Christian ministers. As soon as he said the word Christian, I said, nah, I'm not going to talk to any Christians. He goes, no, I don't expect you to convert or anything else. He said, just promise me you'll at least talk to them. I said, okay, I'll talk to them. I put down the gun that night, and I couldn't even sleep that night because I kept hearing audible voices telling me, don't listen to him. Pick up that gun and glorify yourself. You'll be honored when you get here. But because of his sake and because of my love for him, I put the gun down, didn't do anything. Sure enough, and then I thought, you know, I'm still going to take myself out, but before I go, I'm going to do something that's even going to glorify my master, Satan, and I'm going to walk into that church tomorrow, And I'm going to take those two Christian ministers, I'm going to make them doubt what they believe, I'm going to turn them around from what they believe and convert them over into what I believe. And that's what I thought. So I walked into that church. I mean, and before, he picked me up. You ever seen Hulk Hogan when he pumps up on TV? I mean, that's, I was pumped. I had my satanic Bible marked. I mean, you know, it looked like one of those highlighted Bibles that people have where you can read them miles away. I mean, I had everything because I knew they were going to use scripture on me. And I was going to be ready, you know. And I walked into that church, and I mean, I was, the walls were up. The first minister walked over, and he gave me a big hug, and I said, I'm not going to hug him back. The second one walked over, and he took my hand, he shook it, he looked at me with these eyes, and he said, praise God, brother. He says, I love you so much. And he said, God loves you so much. Do you realize how much love you've missed out on in the last 7.5 years? Now, if he had said anything else, I was ready. But when he said that, it was like, love. Because I'd forgotten what that was. And he showed me through a book. Now, if you ever get a chance to get a copy of this book, you need to pick it up. I guarantee it will bless your life. It's called The Three Wills of God by Leslie Weatherhead. The Three Wills of God by Leslie Weatherhead. And in this book, now follow with me. In this book, it says that God has three basic wills. First one is his intentional will. In other words, you're born for a purpose. He puts you on a path, and that's what he intends for you to do the rest of your life. Okay? The second will is the circumstantial will, which means in the flesh, I have the choice to step off of that road and say, I'm going over here for a while, or I'm going over here for a while, and I'll get back on that road later on. Or circumstances, whether they be outside forces or whatever, temporarily come along and throw you off of that road. But that God has his third will, and his third will is his ultimate will, which means that no matter what you do in the flesh, no matter what the circumstances are, you're ultimately going to end up doing what God intends you to do in the first place. And he showed me that it was not God's intentional will for God to take my father like that. That Satan used that man in sin to kill my father, to get me to turn from the Lord, to use my talents for his purposes, and then ultimately turn around and destroy me also in the end. And I'm going to tell you something, brothers and sisters. I fluctuate between 250, 255. I used to do professional wrestling for 3.5 years. And I couldn't do it in the flesh, but if Satan had appeared in that room, I would have tried to rip his throat out. I mean, that's how angry I was that I found out I'd been lied to for that long. And I took that satanic Bible and I threw it across the room. And I took my demon ring off and I threw it down. I said, I don't want this stuff anymore. It's a lie. He said, now what are you going to do? I said, I don't know. I said, there's probably a contract out on me anyway because I'm defecting. I don't know. I'll just get along. And he said, no. He said, Jesus wants you. I said, yeah, I bet. He goes, no, Jesus really wants you. He said, in fact, when Satan's through with you, he's through with you. When Jesus uses you, he continues to use you as long as you're usable, as long as you're open to being used. I said, well, I don't know. He said, have you ever talked to the Lord? And I said, not for a long, long time. He said, would you like to do that today? I don't know how. He said, talk to him like you would your dad. It's okay. And I went down, and for the first time, I got down on my knees in the chapel. And I'm going to tell you, that's a milestone. Because as a high priest, I used to have people bow to me. But for me to get on my knees, that just wasn't done. And I got down on my knees, and I said, Lord, I said, I don't even know where to start. I said, I'm sorry for all the things that I've done, and I renounce Satan and everything that I ever did for him. They told me that I rose up off that ground, actually levitated on my knees an inch off that ground, off that floor. And how to explain it to you, but I felt something evil tear out of my chest. And I slumped down. I was empty for the first time. And he says, now, just ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart and be your Lord and Savior. And I did. Asked him to come in and be my master from now on. And I thought that was it. You know, I was full, and I was feeling happy, and I was feeling joyous, and I get ready to get up, and he said, now you're going to need the power of God in your life. You're going to need the Spirit, the power of the Spirit, he said, because what you were in, Satan's going to come back at you with full guns loaded. He said, and I said, what's that? And, you know, praise God, I don't know how many ministers would have done that. He took the next 2.5 to 3 hours going through all the scriptures about the Holy Spirit, who he is, what he does, how he does it, and why you need him. And he looked at me and he said, do you want it? I said, I want everything. I've missed out on this stuff for 7 years. I want everything. I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, I got double whammy. I got saved and filled with God's Spirit the same day. And they gave me a Bible because I was so hungry to find out what the truth was. I'd lived a lie for 7 years. I wanted to find out what the truth was. And I couldn't wait. Couldn't wait to tell. I hugged my friend. And all the way home, we were talking about the Lord. We were talking about how I was feeling. And I said, I hope this isn't just a feeling that I'm feeling today and tomorrow I'm going to be back in the old way. He said, no. He said, you died today. You died. You're a new creature. He said, that's what you need to walk in. And I couldn't wait to tell. And you know, the first person that I had to tell was my Satanist wife. And I ran up to the door. And she met me at the door. And I got ready to tell her. And she looked at me and she said, you went and did it, didn't you? You're one of those Christians now. I looked up and I went, oh, God, here we go. You know, but praise God. I mean, the Lord finally brought that relationship to an end, because how many know that if you're not of the same spirit, no matter what your relationship is, it's not going to work. Not going to work. You don't look for Mr. or Mrs. Wright. You see if they know Mr. Wright. Okay? In 1972, one of the things that we got to see because of our position, because of my position, was a pamphlet sent out by the church called the Cloven Hoof II. The Cloven Hoof II was a black pamphlet, and in that were instructions either for your group or plans that the church or what we refer to as the Illuminati were planning on doing. Now, you need to understand that the Illuminati, to a Satanist, you're told that they are very powerful satanic spiritual beings, which is not altogether false, because the people who claim to be the Illuminati are possessed by those beings. Okay? And they said that they sent out this pamphlet, and I saw this in 72. I opened up this pamphlet, and there was a 12-step plan for United States takeover by the year 1984. They were trying to follow right along with George Orwell's book, 1984. The only reason it didn't happen was there were three steps on that plan that didn't take place. The first one was they wanted to create a pseudo-fuel shortage. Now, how many remember in 1973, we were going around and all they were telling you, the gas may be having to be rationed out because we were running low, and all of a sudden here come all these planes flying over the ocean, all huge tankers just sitting there. So that got thwarted. The second step that didn't happen on that was all crops south of the Mason-Dixon line didn't get destroyed. Because if that would have happened, food chain would have literally come to a halt. The grocery stores would have been bare within days. The third step that didn't take place was the assassination of all major evangelists in the United States. Every major evangelist had a hit contract out on them, sent out by the church. And I remember Billy Graham saying years ago on one of his television crusades that he felt like his life was in danger more so than any other time. He doesn't know how right he was. The only reason that they couldn't get to him is because the power of God and protection of God was all over those men. And they find out they couldn't get to him physically, so what they did is they hired church hookers to go and set them up sexually. We can't destroy the minister, so we'll destroy their ministry. So people like Jim Baker, Jimmy Swaggart, and multi-dozens of others all got set up and their ministry destroyed. One of the steps on that plan said this: we will infiltrate the education and media system. We will find a way to make evil look cute. We will seize and capture the minds of all youth. We will implant within them satanic and Luciferian doctrine, theology, and ideology. Then we will take that child and generate him up into adulthood. And as he reaches adulthood, he will pass those things down from generation to generation, from his childhood to the next childhood to the next childhood, until we have captured the minds of every individual. Tonight, what we're going to look at is we're going to look at the steps that they have taken to do just that. They have found a way to make evil look cute, and we're buying it by the drove. A lot of things that we look at now, we look on the surface and we look at it and we see it as being innocent. How many know that Satan doesn't come through the front door? He never comes at you from the front, because that would be giving himself away. What he does is he gets you looking on something from the front, and he slips in through the back. And that's how that operates. And if he can have you afraid of something, he's got control. He controls through fear. One of the things that are out now are the slasher movies, and they're all directed toward teenagers. How many know what I'm talking about? They're all directed at teenagers. That's their target. And I mean, parents, these things are graphic. Graphic. One that comes to mind is the movie Halloween. How many have seen Halloween? For those of you who haven't seen it, there's a young man named Michael Myers. Michael Myers ends up stabbing his sister to death with a big butcher knife on Halloween. And he gets into an institution because they think that he was insane. He gets in an institution and he grows up into adulthood. And the doctor that worked with him all the way from childhood to adulthood now says that every time he looks into Michael Myers' eyes, he sees nothing but pure evil. And on the night of Samhain, which is what we call Halloween, how many know Halloween is nothing more than a celebration of death? Okay, it's the worship of the Celtic god Samhain, god of the dead. On the night of Samhain, Michael Myers escapes from that institution, kills his first victim, which is a worker, seals the overalls off of this worker, and a mask, a Halloween mask that he had in the front seat of his car. And now throughout the rest of the movie, you have a maniacal dressed killer in a Halloween costume. And I mean, he goes around and he kills teenagers, and he kills them graphically and supernaturally. I mean, he uses things that you wouldn't even imagine would kill somebody, like a broomstick. And the worst part of it is you can't kill him. You shoot him, he gets back up. You burn him, no big deal, he's good as new. Blow him up, nothing to him. And at the end of the movie, I mean, the whole thing is like a ride, and that's what they're designed to do. It's like a roller coaster ride. You know, when you go up to a roller coaster and you get to the very top of that thing, and you know you're going to go hundreds of miles an hour down the other end. You know, the thing is that if you can throw your hands up in the air, you the man. And if your girlfriend can do it, she the girl. And that's the thrill of it. And it's a thrill ride. And so the whole object is to be able to sit there, to see if you can sit there with your girlfriend or boyfriend and watch this thing while people your own age are being slaughtered on a big screen. And I mean, it's graphic. And we wonder why our children wake up at night having screaming nightmares. And, you know, just when last in the movie, when they think they kill him and he's gone, no, he's back. Halloween 2, Michael Myers returns. Halloween 3, Halloween 4, Halloween H2O. Praise God, I hope that's the end of it because they cut his head off in the end. And that's supposed to be the end. Now we've got a new one, Scream. Scream 2. Now, praise God, Scream 3. End of the trilogy. I sure hope so. And isn't it coincidence that the killer is again dressed in a Halloween costume and he uses a high technology because he uses a cell phone to find his victims and then stabs them. And they're teenagers. Now, you look at that and you think, well, you know, teenagers. I mean, that's teenage movies. Okay, let's hypothetically say that our teenagers are, you know how they all do, that they love to go for a ride out in the country, you know, on walls. They're just riding. And they go out and on this road and, you know, your boyfriend or your girlfriend or whatever is in the car and you're going for a ride and you decide to stop just to talk. And you're sitting there talking and, you know, like most cars, after you turn them off, they either start up or they don't. And let's say they've been listening to the radio for about a couple of hours, and then they go to turn that off, and all of a sudden, now it's a dark, desolate place. They haven't seen a car go by in hours. What's the first thing that's going to go through their heads? Gee, I hope there's nobody like Michael out here. I hope there's nobody like that Scream guy running around, some serial killer, some maniac. But you see, it's designed to do that. That's what its purpose is to instill fear within our kids. And that's directed toward teenagers. A lot of those things are just out there for that specific purpose, is to get our kids really, really into the point to where they are so afraid that they don't know what they're looking at anymore. And praise God, now we have even movies that are biblically based. Well, kind of. And one of the new ones is called End of Days with Arnold Schwarzenegger. How many remember Arnold? He's Bach. How many have seen End of Days? Oh, you got to go see it. You got to go see it. I mean for action-packed Arnold kind of rough movies, you know, like that, it's great. Biblically, it sucks. But for action, it's great. And in this movie, if you haven't seen this movie, here's the premise. There's a group of priests who discover that 666 is actually 999 backwards. And so that the end of days, or the end of time as we know it, is actually 1999. And that if Satan comes back, I don't know where they think he is, maybe he's on vacation in Bermuda or somewhere in the Bahamas, but he's supposed to come back to the earth and take his role and actually incarnate himself into a human being, and that there's a girl that's been chosen for him to be his special concubine, and the union of them would form the Antichrist. And that this would take place 1999. And if it's not stopped by the year 2000, life as we know it ends. Now, here's the girl, and there's people after her, and she can't figure out why. They're trying to kidnap her. Every place she turns around, they're trying to grab her. And now comes Arnold into the picture. And Arnold is a washed-up, alcoholic, depressed cop who lost his wife and his daughter in a break-in. Two guys broke in and actually raped and killed his daughter and his wife. And now he's depressed to the point where at one point he even puts the gun in his mouth and pulls the trigger. And, you know, Arnold, he doesn't have any luck. It doesn't go off. And now Arnold is assigned to protect this girl. He doesn't know why. And now the priests, in the middle of the movie, the priests are trying to tell him what's going on. And he's saying that they're crazy. He doesn't believe any of it and all this. And at one point, he's in his apartment, and all of a sudden, he gets in confrontation with Satan, the man who's incarnated into them. And he looks at him, and Satan shows him a vision of his wife and his daughter the way they used to be, and says, I can give all that back to you. All you need to do is give up a girl. And, you know, bless Arnold. I mean, you know, he almost gives in, but, you know, he gets that little hero, you know, attitude. And now he says no, and now he's at war with the Prince of Darkness. And at one point of the movie, Arnold is seen, I mean, he's just loaded to the gills with man-made weaponry, and he's pumping up a shotgun, you know. His arms aren't as big as what they used to be because he's off of steroids now. But he's pumping up the gun, and the priest looks at him and says, and where are you going? And he goes, I'm going to save the world. Good luck, Arnold. Man-made weaponry against the Prince of Darkness. So he finds out that doesn't quite work real well. And now all these people are chasing him and chasing the girl. And to make a long story short, because if I was going through the whole thing, you just have to see it. But at the end of this movie, in order for him to stop it, he has to destroy himself. So our hero throws himself on a spear that's being held by a statue of an angel that fell over in a church. And he impales himself on this spear, and he saves the day. And in this particular scene here, Satan turns into a big ball of flame, goes back into hell or back to Bermuda, wherever he was, and he waits for the next 1,000 years. And everything's okay, and Arnold saved the day. Now, as born-again Christians, we look at that thing and go, that was stupid. They didn't have anything to do with the Bible. But what about a young person who's not Bible-based? What about a young person who is not grounded in prophecy? What is the message to them? Not when all hell breaks loose and Satan takes his reign on the earth and the son of perdition arises, we don't look for our redemption to come and the Lord of glory to come back and burn up the wicked with the brightness of his coming. No! You look to someone like Arnold to step forward and save the world. That was my old impression. One of the other movies, it was very popular. Practical Magic. Yeah. Practical Magic. Starring Nicole Kidman, Sandra Bullock. And these are two sisters that are brought up into generational witchcraft. In fact, their aunts are both witches, and they bring them up as small children into the world of witchcraft. And Sandra Bullock, she falls in love with a mortal man, but she's afraid that if the mortal man finds out she's a witch, he'll drop her like a hot potato. So she goes into the closet. She's a closet witch. And this little mischievous lady over here has a very spirited evil boyfriend. And at one point in the movie, the evil boyfriend gets killed, and they try to bring him back, and a demon comes back with him. And now she's possessed, going after her, And at one point now, she comes out of the closet, and she decides the only way to save her sister is to come out of the closet and be the witch that she was called to be. So they have a big coming out party for her, and all the aunts call all the other witches around the neighborhoods, and they all come over there, and they form this big circle out of broomsticks. And they put the young sister inside that circle, and they do their incantations and all their spells, and they cast that demon out. And that demon comes out, and he burns up, and he goes into ashes, and they sweep him out the door, and they've been making a big cauldron of gunk. And so when they sweep him out into a hole, and they take that cauldron, and they pour it over into that hole and seal him up. And then at the end, Sandra ends up marrying the mortal man, and they live happily ever after. Now I'm going to tell you something. That movie was entertaining. At one point, it was comical. At some point, they actually knew what they were doing when they put stuff in there. But it had a message to it. And that is that you fight witchcraft with witchcraft. You got a person put a spell on you, don't worry, go put a spell on them. You see the message that's being portrayed? Another popular TV show that's on now is called Brimstone. And Brimstone, I mean, it's atrocious. There's a cop that was a bad cop, and he was evil, and he dies, goes to hell, and now his assignment, given by Satan, is to go out and catch all the demons that escaped from hell and bring them back. And that's the premise of the show, and that's what happens every episode. He's going out and searching for these demons. Another one is South Park. I mean, if you watch South Park, that stuff is atrocious. You've got third and fourth graders, supposed to be third and fourth grade characters, and they are cursing. I mean, they are rebellious. They rebel against parental authority. And, I mean, at one point, there was one episode where there was a Jesus character having a boxing match with a Satan character. And, you know, TV hasn't escaped that either. Ladies, there's soap operas that have got that stuff on it. One of the ones that come to mind is called Passions. Brand new one. Complete with a witch. A good witch and a bad witch. And there's even a familiar named Timmy that can turn himself into a doll and then transpose himself into a young boy on a soap opera. And the whole premise of this thing is good against evil, but not the kind of good that we know. It's occult good against occult evil. The whole thing is that there's messages being delivered in these things. And if we're looking at it on the surface, we're not going to see it. We're going to have to look at it from the inside out. Another one was Days of Our Lives. For Days of Our Lives, for 4 to 6 months, they had one episode where one of the heroines was possessed, demon-possessed. I mean, to the point to where they even did the makeup and everything else. And they made this girl look like, they made Linda Blair look kindergarten. I mean, this was on a soap opera. And it went all the way through, and you kept wondering, you know, are they really going to be able to cast this spirit out? Are they really going to be able to cast this spirit out? And all of a sudden, here comes a defrocked priest who's in love with this girl that's possessed. And, of course, he decides that because he's learned all these things, he's going to do an exorcism, and he does an exorcism. And finally, they get this demon cast out. But the whole thing is that these messages are out there. Sabrina the Teenage Witch, one of the most popular watched TV programs. And Sabrina and her friends battle evil wizards, warlocks, all through the show. And again, it's fighting witchcraft with witchcraft. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you some symbols. I'm going to start out, before we get into the meat of this thing, I'm going to show you some symbols. I'm going to start out showing you symbols. These are occult symbols. And the reason for you seeing these symbols is you're going to see them in Pokemon. You're going to see them in video screens that you see. You're going to see them in a lot of the books that we're going to go into. And you need to understand what it is that you're seeing when you see it. Now, I believe that every Christian has been given a certain amount of discernment. And what we need to do is we need to ask our Heavenly Father to sharpen that discernment so that you get this into your spirit and you get this into your mind so that when you see it, I don't have to tell you what it is. It's like, boom, all of a sudden you see it and you go, okay, that was that. Okay? So what we're going to do is we're going to start out with symbols, and I'm going to share these with you. Here's the first one. This is the universal symbol of Satanist churches. It's called the symbol of Baphomet, also the goat of Mendes. And you notice now it's a five-pointed star, inverted, 2 points up signifying the break with Christianity, this point down symbolizing that the center is hell or Satan, and it's a circle within a circle. You notice that there's a goat's head inside this star. Now, how many remember in the Old Testament the scapegoat, when the people of Israel were told to put the sins upon the scapegoat and send it out in the wilderness, and that's what atoned for their sins? Now, when you're inducted into Satanism, they tell you, poor old Lucifer, he was kicked out of heaven by God, and all he did was ask why God had the throne. And so now that everything that you, and you do, we have to blame it on somebody, and we blame it on poor old Satan. So he's referred to as the scapegoat. And you notice that there are keys going around the outside of that circle. This is actually a writing, and it's called Enochian. Enochian keys. It's older than Sanskrit. And it actually spells out a word. And that word is Leviathan, which is the creature from the abyss, I believe in the book of Job. So this is the satanic pentagram. When you see that, you know exactly what that is, that that's the symbol of United Satanist Churches. Here's the next one. This is the universal symbol of witchcraft. It's called a pentagram. The reason it's called a pentagram is it's a five-pointed star, and if you were to intersect those lines, in other words, if you were to draw those lines where they would intersect with each other, that would form the pentagram. I drew it like this so you could actually see the makeup of the star itself. Witches wear these or draw these on the floor and then stand inside of them and summon up the spirits and charge the atmosphere on the outside. And they believe that by lighting candles on each point of that star, standing inside of this and charging the atmosphere, as long as they're inside that circle, they are protected. How many know that demons don't need you to draw something on the floor if they want to really get to you? Okay? This is another way that Satan keeps them in bondage by making them think that they are the ones that are in control. Not the witches themselves, but that's what Satan wants them to make them think. That's how he keeps them going. Here's the next one. This is a hexagram, exactly as it sounds. This symbol is used in black magic. It comes from the Jewish Kabbalah, Jewish magic. It is a symbol of dark summoning. What I mean by that is that if you want to put a hex on somebody, you want to cause a spirit to come forth, this is a symbol that's used. It's called a hexagram. Now, it is not, never has been, never will be the Star of David. Show me in Scripture anywhere where David was instructed to come up with a symbol of a star representing him or the city or the country of Israel. It's not there. The other thing is that Solomon was a wise king, but he was also a dabbler. Why do I say that? Because Solomon had many wives. And those wives came from different cultures. And those different cultures worshiped different gods. And guess what they brought to the marriage with them? Witchcraft. They brought those gods with them. Why do I say that? I don't. God does. Go to 1 Kings chapter 11. Starting with verse 1. But when King Solomon loved many strange women... Why were they strange? Because they didn't worship the same God. They didn't worship the God of Israel. Together with the daughters of Pharaoh, women of the Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Sidonians, and Hittites, of the nations concerning which the Lord said unto the children of Israel, ye shall not go into them, neither shall they come in unto you, for surely they will turn away your heart after their gods. Solomon clave unto these in love. And he had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. For it came to pass when Solomon was old that his wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not perfect with the Lord his God, as was the heart of David his father. For Solomon went after Ashtoreth, which is also called Ashtaroth, the goddess of the Sidonians, and after Milcom, the abomination, there's that word, of the Ammonites. And Solomon did evil in the sight of the Lord, and went not fully after the Lord, as did David his father. Then did Solomon build a high place for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab, in the hill that is before Jerusalem, and for Molech, the abomination of the children of Ammon. And likewise did he for all his strange wives, which burnt incense and sacrificed unto their gods. And the Lord was angry with Solomon, because the heart was turned from the Lord God of Israel, which had appeared unto him twice. Now go to the book of Amos, chapter 5. God's getting ready to reveal something here. Chapter 5, and we're going to start with verse 25. God is not in a good mood here. The people of Israel, the children of Israel, have been very foolish, and he's correcting them like a good daddy does. And he says in verse 24, "But let judgment run down as waters, and righteousness as a mighty stream. Have ye offered unto me sacrifices and offerings in the wilderness 40 years, O house of Israel?" Verse 26, "But ye have borne the tabernacle of your Molech and Chion, your images, the star of your God, which ye made to yourselves." When Solomon had the temple built, he used people from a land called Tyre. Tyre worshipped a god called Baal. This is the symbol of Baal, not the stars of David. This is the seal of Solomon. It comes from the Jewish Kabbalah. And in that time, that's Jewish magic. You see, not all Jews worship the same god. Does that mean that the people of Israel, because they've taken that symbol for the symbol of their country, does that mean that they're evil? No. They're deceived. It's very subtle. And Satan, we all know that Satan can deceive people very, very well. Here's the next one. Everybody recognizes the one at the top. All-seeing eye. One found on the back of the dollar bill, and also the seal of the Illuminati. But what you don't know, or may not know, is that the triangle has always been a very powerful occultic symbol, because it's a spell-casting symbol, and it actually represents the three elements of all witchcraft: earth, wind, and fire. Hey, wasn't there a group called that? Huh. Down here is a symbol, and it's an Egyptian symbol, and it's called the Ankh. It is the universal symbol of reincarnation. It's the worship of the sun god Ra and his son Horus. And you notice, now this was in existence before Jesus, but you notice it almost became a mockery, because as it comes up, it has a cross, and then it loops. And that means that life doesn't end, it just continues on and on and on and on. Universal symbol of reincarnation, the Ankh. And you know, it just really gets my heart, because I've been going through, on this last tour, I've been going through airport after airport, and I've seen these things being worn on young men with big gold chains, you know, hanging all around their neck. And I pray to God they don't know what that means. I really do. Here's the next one. Now, the one at the top you've already seen. That's a satanic pentagram. But this one down here is a very interesting symbol. This was actually introduced as a piece of jewelry in 1969, early 1970. Oh, by the way, how many have heard of Sarah Coventry jewelry? Anybody here sell it? Praise God, because Sarah Coventry jewelry is exactly as it sounds, Sarah's Coven. You see, witchcraft groups get their money to operate by two ways: the selling of themselves and drugs, or the making and selling of occult jewelry. And what they actually do is they ask this stuff to be blessed after they make it. Now, I mean, when I'm talking about blessed, I'm not talking about how God blesses us by giving us something. I'm talking about when they bless it, it means it's cursed. And they actually ask demonic entities to come and go inside of that piece of jewelry. Now, I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, if you believe Scripture, where Jesus himself even says that there's such a thing as demonic possession, in other words, demons can inhabit a person, then you also must know that demons can and do inhabit inanimate objects. I've seen it happen over and over again. And praise God, you know, we go over to countries like Africa, or even closer than that, we go over to Hawaii, and we bring back these masks or these tiki dolls, and we put them on our mantle or on our wall and think, oh, that's a great souvenir. And guess what you just brought back into your home with you? The demons that were associated with those particular gods. This is actually a Celtic symbol, and it's over 2,000 years old. Referred to as the Italian horn, the horn of plenty, or the leprechaun's horn. And actually what it means is that the wearer of this trusts the devil for their finances. Here are two crosses. First cross is called the Tau cross, T-A-U, and it's actually a Babylonian symbol. But what happened was the Buddhists and the Hindus picked this up and said, we like that. We're going to use that as a symbol of good luck. Good luck if you wear it. Okay? And you notice, it probably doesn't even mean to be, but you notice it's kind of a mockery of our cross too, because as it comes up, it just stops. There's no ascension. This one down here is the inverted cross. Most of the time it's black. This is like what I saw on the wall of my mentor's house. And this is flown. This is actually one of the biggest blasphemies of Christianity, because it means that Christ did literally nothing on the cross. That's what it's supposed to represent. And these are flown at the time when black masses are taking place. And black masses are when you have your animal and human sacrifice. Here's a symbol for black mass at the top. And you notice that it looks like an ankh, but this is actually a high priestess. And the reason I say that is, there's her symbol, which is a crescent moon. You see, in witchcraft, they don't just worship one god, they worship many. Lucifer is only one of them, one of the lesser ones, in fact. Because their highest god is actually a female god, a goddess. And her name is Diana, goddess of the moon. And this is her symbol, crescent moon and stars. Most of the time, if it's a symbol, it's a symbol of the high priestess, she'll wear it around her neck as a pendant or a brooch, and it will have the crescent moon, and it'll have 1, 2, 3, or 4 stars hanging off of it, and that symbolizes her rank in that particular coven. So this is the symbol of the goddess Diana. This is the high priestess, and this over here actually is a symbol for the sacrifice getting ready to take place. A lot of law enforcement officials now are finding out that these symbols that they're finding on culverts and overpasses that they once thought were gang symbols are actually satanic cults. This symbol down here, I hope everybody can see that. This symbol right here is a really interesting symbol. Again, it's a Celtic or Druid symbol, and it was adopted in the 1970s by a rock and roll band called Blue Oyster Cult. And during all the interviews that Blue Oyster Cult did with their magazine people, they said, all the interviews, they wanted to know why that symbol and what that symbol meant, because people couldn't figure it out. And Blue Oyster Cult members told them that, well, we can't tell you what it is, but it's a very mystical symbol, and one day it will reveal itself. Well, it has. This is called the Cross of Confusion. Now, I even talked to one gentleman who at one point said, well, that's a Christian symbol, because there's the cross and then there's the fisherman's hook. No. You see the hole in the cross? That symbolizes the hole in Christianity. And this going down here means Jesus went into the grave and never came back up. In other words, it's a sign symbolizing that God is dead. One at the top is the new symbol for the Church of Satan. The reason I say new, Anton Zandor LaVey passed away in 1997 at the age of 67. He had heart problems all the way through his later life. and he passed away. And for a while, it looked like the church was going to go under, and I was getting kind of excited about that. And they were even on their website, they were soliciting people for money to send it in to try to save the house, which was the church. And it didn't work. And the city of San Francisco wanted to tear it down and build a complex over it. There was a lot of estate money owed on it. And he said, they said that it looked like it was going to go under. Sadly to say, October 31st, 1999, Carla LeVay's oldest daughter, stepped forward and said, I'm going to follow where my father left off. I'm going to take over his estate. I'm going to take over his position. Deemed herself the high priestess of the Church of Satan, and now the Church of Satan is alive and well again. This down here at the bottom has never been, never will be, a symbol for peace. It's a symbol of the broken cross. When you're initiated into Satanism, you're given a ceramic cross. You're told to turn that cross upside down, take the 2 points and break them down, symbolizing that there is no God. Also, in any occult book, you'll find that this is a very powerful symbol used because it's called the crow's foot when it's reversed. It's a spell-casting symbol. But you see how subtle Satan got it into our... This came out about the time when the Vietnam War was going on and the Flower Children. And you notice at that time, basically what it was a rebellion against authority. But, you know, it like tune in, tune out, turn on and tune out, to get high. And so that's what that is. Actually, that symbol. I do not know what that particular symbol, what this new symbol stands for. I have not been able to find that out. A lot of the people that I was in touch with that I was able to ask have moved away, or I just can't get a hold of them anymore, so I have my resources are not around too much. I know that that looks like a symbol for infinity, but what that double cross here, unless that's exactly what it's supposed to mean, is double cross. But I'm not sure exactly what that is. Here's the next one. One at the top is a symbol for anarchy. It means you're against everything. Parental authority, government authority, no matter what it is, you're against it. One down here in the bottom is an interesting symbol. You've all seen the all-seeing eye, the pyramid. Well, this is another symbol for the seal of the Illuminati. It's a circle within a circle. This circle on the outside is supposed to represent the networks that go about making up the Illuminati, and this circle in the inside is supposed to represent all the men who make up the actual Illuminati itself. But what you may not realize is that the circle in paganism and other cultures has another meaning to it, and that is that it represents the female womb or female fertility. So when you see the circle in other things that have to do with paganism or have to do with witchcraft, you can associate that with feminine spirit power, having to do with fertility rites, having to do with the female womb. The circle has always been a very powerful symbol. Always has been, always will be, until the time that witchcraft no longer exists. Witches use that to represent themselves to other witches. And a lot of times on a lot of their symbols, what they'll wear on their hats or they'll wear on a brooch will be nothing more than a metallic circle. And that represents them as being witchcraft and also a feminine spirit power. So when you see that, now you'll know what that means. Circle within a circle, or just a circle itself as being a very powerful symbol in witchcraft. And this is the next symbol, and this again is the symbol of the goddess Diana. You'll see there's the crescent moon and there's the star. Now, the stars doesn't have to be particular in that particular order. I've seen them where they're coming down a straight line here, where they're going into a curve. And again, like I told you, most of the time, if it's a high priestess, if it's a symbol of the high priestess, it'll be a crescent moon here, and then there would be 1, 2, 3, or 4 stars hanging off of there, depending on their rank in that particular witchcraft coven. This one down here at the bottom is a newer symbol, and it's actually used by what I call the dabblers. You see, there's two basic facets that I want to actually state here of witchcraft or Satanism. And that is that you have the ones that are the elite, and that means those are the planners. In other words, how are we going to get witchcraft into the school system? How are we going to get into the education system? How are we going to get it into the toys? How are we going to get it into the books? Those are the ones that do the planning. Those are the ones I refer to as being the elite. Then you have the dangerous ones, and the dangerous ones are considered to be the dabblers. The dabblers are the ones that are going to grab a cat and take it out and on a tombstone somewhere and choke it to death or stab it with a knife, thinking that they're going to get favoritism from the devil. Okay, those are the dabblers. Those are the ones who are dangerous, because those are the ones who are getting the stuff out of a book somewhere, reading it, and then going out and trying it. Okay. In this particular, this is actually a symbol of the dabblers. Now, this is teenage Satanism right here. It's their symbol. And this means the left-hand path. And the reason for that is, you see that broken arrow there? That's a break with all parental authority, all any kind of authority whatsoever in that circle. It means they're breaking out of that circle, and they're following this symbol here, the black path, which is referred to as Satan. So this means that you're breaking away from everything, and you're following the left-hand path. And that's what that symbol is referred to, is the symbol of the left-hand path. Here's the next one. Now, this is an important symbol for you to get into your mind. These are two mazes. The first one up here at the top is called the labyrinth. And if you notice, it comes around, and then it has an opening here. That stands for feminine serpent power. And it's a powerful symbol for feminine fertility. And the reason for that is that symbolizes the womb. This down here symbolizes male fertility or male serpentine spirit power. And if you see that, I don't know if you can see that. See that? It comes into a double-headed snake. See the head there? And then right here, those are supposed to be forming two snakes as it comes around. And that's called the spiral. And the spiral in paganism, both of these are pagan symbols. And one at the top, the labyrinth, actually represents feminine fertility. The one at the bottom represents the spiral, male fertility power. This is the next one. This is the satanic S, or satanic Z. This was adopted in the 1970s by a rock and roll band called Kiss, and they adopted that on the end of their name, thinking that people would think it looked cool. Actually, it stood for Kings in Satan's Service. And because they were serving Satan, in fact, Gene Simmons, the bass player, the leader of the group, even is a professed Satanist and says that he likes being demon-possessed. And Satan has always been referred to as a lightning bolt. Where do I get that? If you go to the book of Luke, chapter 10, verse 18, it says, and Jesus speaking, it says, "And I beheld Satan fall as lightning from heaven." Satanists grabbed onto that right quick and said, cool, we'll make Satan the lightning bolt, and that'll be his representation. And we can put that in things, and people won't know what that means. We can get our symbol on things, whether it's a toy, whether it's in a video game or whatever. We can get that in a book. People won't know what that means. Okay? They didn't count on discerning Christians. This was also adopted by the Nazi SS. How many know that Hitler was a very avid follower of the occult? Hitler believed in a spear of destiny. Occult theology, it said there was a spear of destiny. And he believed, because this occult theology said that the holder of this spear would become the ruler or the master of the world. And every time that Hitler and his army would invade a particular city, the first thing that he would do would be to send out his soldiers to gather up all the occult books in that particular area, because he was looking for that one book that told him where to find the spear of destiny. He never found it. But Satan is referred to as a lightning bolt. And so that double S up there is what that symbol is, the symbol of Satan. Here's the next one. Now, this is very interesting. If you see here, there's the satanic pentagram. But this symbol down here actually started out as being a Buddhist symbol in Buddhism, and it meant good luck and prosperity. Now, remember that Hitler was a very avid follower of the occult. He was also a very avid follower of one of the most infamous Satanists of all time, named Aleister Crowley. And Mr. Crowley wrote a book called Magic, M-A-J-I-C-K. And in that book, he said, let all initiates of the satanic doctrine do all things backwards. Walk backwards, talk backwards, write backwards, and play backwards. And that way, People will look at you and think you're either eccentric or just simply insane, let you alone, and let you go ahead and do your activities without anybody persecuting you. So Satan have known this for many, many hundreds of years, and they've been doing things backwards, writing things backwards. You want to know if something is of God or not? Reverse it. Look here. What Hitler did was take that symbol, follow Aleister Crowley, and reverse it. And that's all he did. Simply reverse it and made it mean something else. Again, he was a follower of Aleister Crowley, and that's what Aleister Crowley said to do in his book, Magic. Symbol at the top again, hexagram. I want you to see it again. This down here is a scarab. It's also an Egyptian symbol of reincarnation. And where they get this from is really, listen. When the Egyptians used to watch dung beetles, D-U-N-G, okay, dung beetles, push camel dung, little balls of camel dung across the ground, they looked at that and in their great wisdom said, that's the way the sun gods move the sun across the sky. And they saw these dung beetles actually bury the dung into the ground, and then days later, a beetle come out of it, and they assumed right away that this was that same beetle that went into the ground coming back up as a new beetle. In other words, reincarnated. Well, what actually happened was the beetle went in there and laid eggs, and one of the new beetles came out. But they looked at that. I mean, and that goes to show you what kind of wisdom actually goes in to build up a lot of this occult theology. But it's a symbol, again, of reincarnation. In some cultures, it's also referred to as a symbol for good luck and prosperity. Here's the next one. One at the top is symbol for sexual ritual. Again, these are the dabblers that are coming up with these particular symbols here. Like I said, they're starting to find these on culverts and overpasses and things and finding out that these are not actual gang symbols now, that they are actual occult satanic symbols. And this is a symbol for satanic sexual ritual. And down in here is the cross, the satanic cross of justice. That's why it has the pitchfork type appendages on the bottom of that. Again, this is put out by the dabblers. This is not the elite. These are the dabblers who are going out there and thinking that it's cool to worship Satan and that Satan rules and, you know, it's fun to go out and kill cats and whatever else you can find and sacrifice them to Satan. These are two symbols here. The first one at the top is for blood ritual. It means it's a sacrifice, blood sacrifice. And down here is satanic justice. Whenever a Satanist defects and they have a contract out on them, because I'm going to tell you something, when you defect from the satanic church, you're not playing around with a group of penny-ante people. They put a contract out. I had a contract out on my life. A gentleman asked me, said, weren't you ever afraid when you got out? I was scared to death. Until the Lord gave me a vision. And that was him walking into these gates, taking the parchment paper out of Satan's hand that I had actually signed my name in blood on, pulling it out of his hand, taking a key from him and saying, he's mine now. And I've never worried about it since. But this is the symbol for satanic justice. This is top one is the incursive hexagram, and this was the symbol that Aleister Crowley came up for his infamous organization called the Golden Dawn, and this was their symbol. Down here is a New Age symbol, and how many know the New Age is not new at all? It's just a return to the old craft. It's actually witchcraft, paganism. It's going back to the old ways. There's nothing New Age about it. And this symbolizes Holy Earth. You know, the Mother Gaia, have you hugged your tree today type thing. This one up here at the top is Bad Company. Again, these are the dabblers. Up here means Bad Company. A lot of people looked and thought that was a seal for a gang called the Folk. It's not. This is actually a satanic symbol. those three up there, the three leaders of this particular group, and this shows that there are one, two, three other members in that group, and that the ladies are right here. One, two, three. Bad company. And that's what it refers to. Again, the triangle, earth, wind, and fire, always been a very powerful spell-casting symbol. Earth, wind, and fire. Symbol at the top is called Vive, and it's a voodoo symbol. And I want to tell you that I thought that Las Vegas was going to be the sin capital of the world. How many have heard that? Okay? I mean, on tour, and I believe it was last month that I was there, yeah. Last month, I was fully expected to see Las Vegas be the sin capital of the world. I mean, I fully expected to walk in and see all kinds of things going on. But you know what? It has nothing over New Orleans. New Orleans is witchcraft central. I mean, you walk down there and every place you turn is voodoo. They even have a store in there that you can walk in and for $19.95, you can buy a witchcraft doll and a voodoo doll and you can make your own hexes and everything else. Isn't that great? So that's what this is a symbol of voodoo. Okay, right here. And down in here is called the wheel, or the wheel of life. Again, this is another symbol that life continues on and on and on, and it doesn't stop. Anytime that you see a wheel like this, it means that it continues. Symbol at the top is the all-seeing eye of Horus. Again, Egyptian symbol, another reincarnation symbol. This symbol at the bottom is a very interesting symbol. I want to tell you about it. It's a Celtic symbol. It's a Druid symbol. And it's over 2,000 years old. And you need to understand that at the time of the Celts, over 2,000 years old, when the Celtic religion was flourishing, they worshipped many deities. But the greatest deity that they worshipped was a triple goddess. Now, in Christianity, we have God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And they are all male in origin. In their religion, they have a triple goddess, and it's all female. And this is that symbol. This stands for the mother goddess, which represents integrity. This is the daughter goddess that represents wisdom. And this is the crone, or the child, and represents the earth and all power. And then this is the circle that intertwines them throughout life. In other words, the power that intertwines them throughout life. This was also adopted in 1970 by a rock and roll band called Led Zeppelin. And they put it on Led Zeppelin IV, which is also actually referred to as Led Zeppelin runes. And runes are Celtic fortune-telling symbols. And this is one of the symbols that are in runes. But this is a 2,000-year-old symbol. It's Celtic. And it means the worship of a triple goddess. Sarah Coventry specialty. Look at this. Now you can get the symbol of the triple goddess. There's the mother, the daughter, the crone. And now they've taken the circle out, and bless their hearts, they put it in a triangle. Isn't that nice? Now, guys, you know what to get your wife for her anniversary. Not. Here it appears on a New Age, again, New Age is not New Age, book called Aquarian Conspiracy, put out by a lovely woman named Marilyn Ferguson. And Marilyn Ferguson, bless her heart, seems to think that all the social problems on the face of the earth are caused by us, the Christians, because we worship this one God, not all the many ones that should be worshipped. And she seems to think that the greatest thing that could happen is for us to be wiped off so this new thought can come into existence. And that this new thought will not take place until we're gone. Now I have a question. If that particular symbol is 2,000 years old, it's a Celtic symbol, and it means the worship of their triple goddess, what in the world is it doing on something we call holy? Now, you can only come to two conclusions, only two. Number one, Nelson Publishing Company said, well, that's the symbol for the Holy Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Or that's on there because it is a counterfeit version of God's Word. If you take the New King James Bible and compare it to the King James Bible, you will find words that have been omitted, left off, downplayed, and downright perverted. I'm going to tell you something, brothers and sisters. You ever run across a version of God's Word that even downplays one little bit the power of the blood of Jesus Christ, you get rid of that thing. Because the blood of Jesus is what gives you your spiritual authority to trample over Him and His minions. Yes. Praise God. That was for somebody. Here is a little bit of Celtic jewelry. I won't go through and tell you what all of it means. I think you can pretty much figure it out. There's your triangles intertwined with each other. There's your pentagram. This is actually a good luck charm right here. There's your pentagram again. This is a wolf's head and is actually supposed to give you animal spirit power. Okay? Down in here, you see what looks like a horned beast. This is actually supposed to represent the god Pan, P-A-N. So that's a little bit of Celtic jewelry. Now, let's look at some of the jewelry that is out there today. Here's a good, nice piece. Look at this. Here you have a pendant that has your pentagram on it. Look, now you can get your crescent, moon, and stars around it. Lovely piece. I mean, that would go with any dress, wouldn't it? Praise God. Look at this. Now you can get your pentagram and your horoscope with it. Because this is your pentagram, and all these symbols around there represent astrology symbols. So you can wear that thing 24 hours a day and attract all the good fortune you want. Along with other things. Amen. Look at this. This comes from Blue Moon Jewelry. Look here. Here's your pentagram. Here's your crescent moon, and now you've got your goddess hanging off of it. Wouldn't that be lovely? And guys, if you're really into eroticism, you can get one made of goddesses. Everybody see that? That's a pentagram made of goddesses, and the legs are forming actually the pentagram. Nude goddesses. Here's another one. Here's your pentagram. And now you have a crystal hanging off of it. Now, in occultism, a crystal is a very powerful symbol because they believe that that stone actually can catch and harness the powers of the sun, the moon, the stars in that particular jewel. And when you wear that thing around your neck, you've got people wearing this thing thinking that it's attracting goodwill, good fortune, good charm, good luck, and prosperity. Well, it doesn't attract any of those things. It attracts demons. Okay? So that's the kind of thing that we've got out there today. And again, these are not things that you have to boggle your mind to find. These are things that are in your own backyard. You can go to your jewelry stores and find these things. Here's one. This is particularly for witches, because now you can get a pendant with your pentagram on it. There's your magic wand, your chalice, and your athame, which is your magical dagger, and you wear all those as a pendant around your neck. I'm going to show you one of my favorites. Look at this. And they're really bold now, because they say, "Behold the power of the crystal when it is endowed with the magic of Merlin, a remarkable pendant bearing the image of the master sorcerer, sculptured in sterling silver and coated in 24-karat gold, set with a stunning amethyst crystal and a genuine emerald, a rich reminder of the glories of Arthur's kingdom and a good fortune amulet to wear proudly." This is my very favorite. My very favorite. Look at this. This is a good way to usher in the millennium. With an Egyptian millennium pendant. Mark the millennium by wearing the ancient Egyptian symbol of enduring life, the Ankh. once prized by the pharaohs, now crafted for you in sterling silver, paired with a stunning falcon symbol of the sun god Horus, bathed in radiant 24-karat gold, the fitting way to celebrate the world's glorious history and the promise of the universe as it unfolds for the next 1,000 years. Both symbols together form a brooch, separate them for a dynamic pendant. So now you can wear it like this, or you can take this off and have this and have your two little locks on the side. So now, ladies, you know what you can get your husband for their anniversary. These are being found all over jewel stores, stores where they sell the little pewter statues. And these are swords with your crystal in it. Depending on what your birthday is, it actually has your stone for that, so that it attracts goodwill and good fortune and good luck, and good luck if you wear it. This is the fairy star. How many know that fairies are actually demons? It comes from Celtic folklore. So when you tell your child about the tooth fairy, you're actually talking about a demon. Okay? This is that particular star, the fairy star, and each one of those points stand for specific elements that make up the universe, the fairy star. Here is Sarah Coventry. And now they're not even afraid to come out and be bold and present it in a nice piece of jewelry. Look at this. There's your triple goddess, complete with a crystal-looking ball in the middle of that thing. And this is jewelry that you can go out and actually buy, purchase. Here's, again, the symbol, that particular same symbol. And now it's intertwined, and you know what those are? Those are serpents. See the head? Those are serpents. Isn't that lovely? This, again, is a symbol for the triple goddess. And the reason I say that is, you'll see that there are three crescent moons. Remember that their highest goddess is a goddess called Diana. There's her symbol. There's one, two, three, and then there's the circle of life. Oh, wait a minute. Isn't that the same symbol that's used for hazardous waste material? Huh. You know, let's get something straight here. God doesn't need symbols. God does not need symbols to identify things of his realm. Who needs symbols? We do. Man has been a symbolic creature ever since history began. We've needed something to represent this and some other symbol to represent that, because somehow or another we can't tell one thing from the other without a symbol. We call them now logos. Everywhere you look, every particular company's got a particular logo that identifies them and separates them from something else. We are very symbolic. Dreamcatcher. These things in Indian lore are supposed to catch and filter out bad dreams. Do you know what they actually do? They actually filter in the bad dreams. Talked to a lady about a month ago on the phone who was very upset. Her child had been given one of these dream catchers as a plaything over the baby's crib, and put it on over the baby's crib, and thinking that it was going to filter out the bad dreams. This baby would not sleep for 3 straight months. 3 months, this baby could not sleep. I mean, wake up in the middle of the night screaming. And Dad would go in and hold him. And Mom would go in and hold him. And it wouldn't work. They'd lay him down in the crib and they'd go back to bed and the baby would start screaming again. I told him, remove this thing. Get that thing out of your house. It's cursed. She did. She pleaded the power of the blood of Jesus over it. Said she's casting it out of her life. Cast it out. The next night, she said the baby slept perfectly. These things are designed for another purpose other than what they tell you they're designed for. In other words, what they say is one thing, what they actually do is something else. I think, though, that you can see how subtle this whole stuff is. I mean, if he can get it, if Satan can get this stuff in jewelry and get us to wear it around our neck, thinking that it represents good fortune or you know, good luck or charm and everything else like that, and we go about wearing it, I mean, what better way for him to get a foothold in our life? Now, a lot of things come over from the Orient. A lot of things come over from the Orient. And some things have a big impact on us, and some things don't. I can't think of anything that come over from the Orient that actually had a big impact or a phenomenon-type craze other than Godzilla. But there is something new that's come over to the United States and has actually captured the minds and the imagination of every single child. And you know what? It's not new at all. Japanese kids have been watching this thing since 1995. It started out as a cartoon, went to a comic book. They made it into a video game, went to toys, collectible card game. Now, praise God, there's even a movie on it. And it was started in 1995. It's not new, but it's new to kids, and they're eating it up. And it's called Pokemon. And it stands for Pocket Monster. And it even made the cover of Time magazine. Now, the first thing I want you to notice is, do you notice any symbol up there that you've seen before? The spiral. And it stands for what? Male fertility. Okay? Now, this thing is actually called Poliwhirl, but they actually had another name for it before they renamed it. When this creature first came out, it was called Hypno. And they changed it to Poliwhirl to make it a little more innocent. But you see, what it actually does is it's supposed to be able to mesmerize and hypnotize its enemies. And you can see how that would happen. That starts spinning around, and it's just like one of those hypnotic wheels that they use to hypnotize. And you see up here in the top, here's a creature, an alligator-type creature over here, dragon. Kind of a funny duck-billed thing down here. And this is an interesting character over here. This character over here is called Mewtwo. And Mewtwo looks like an alien. If you look at him real carefully, he looks like an alien. But you know, the first thing that I noticed about that thing is, when I looked at it, and I looked at those eyes, I said, you know what? That kind of looks like the things that we used to pray to inside that circle. Now you notice that he has a particular salute that he's given. And he's in this pose. Every time that you see Mewtwo, he's in this pose. Now he has three fingers. And those three fingers are always sticking out like that. Now he doesn't have five fingers like we do. He has three. But if they were the three on us, they'd be this. And that doesn't mean hook 'em horns, doesn't mean I love you, doesn't mean one more, it means hail Satan. It's the satanic salute that all Satanists identify themselves with. And it says here, you look here, it says, for many kids, it's now an addiction. Very much so. Cards, video games, toys, a new movie, is it bad for them? What we need to look at is whether or not that particular statement holds true. Is it bad for them? Here's one of the characters. Cute little one. Everybody, okay, everybody go, oh, come on. I know you wanted to do that, see? That's why I did that. He's cute. But the one thing I noticed about him right off, this is Pikachu. One thing I noticed about him right off was his tail. It's a lightning bolt. And it's a satanic Z. It even comes down here to a point. Now, just by looking at him enough alone is not enough to really be able to say, okay, yeah, that's bad, or that's satanic. What we first need to do is we need to look at the actual production of these things. And the first thing we need to do is we need to look at who actually produced the trading card game that has captured the minds and the imaginations of our children. Now, it doesn't make any difference what I say. It's what their own material says, because their own material will give them away. Okay? So I'm going to read to you, here's a direct quote from the web pages of the producer of this game. Listen to this. The Pokemon trading card game is a new collectible card game that is made and distributed by Wizards of the Coast. What is a wizard? male practitioner of black magic. Wizards of the Coast, the same company that made the best-selling game Magic the Gathering. Magic the Gathering is a heavily occult-laced trading card game which has been very popular in the 90s. And I should also tell you that Wizards of the Coast also owns a subsidiary company named TSR, and TSR is the company that puts out all Dungeons and Dragons material. So let's look at Magic the Gathering, because this is the same company that puts out Pokemon. So let's see where they're coming from. Now, from seeing the symbols, your actual discernment should now begin to be sharpened. How many see a circle? How many see a pentagram? Yeah. If you look, there it is. See that? Magic the Gathering. This is a role-playing game. Now, parents, in case you don't know what that is, that means that your child actually becomes a character in the game, actually becomes a part of the game. And that's what makes it exciting, is there's not many games out there that they can actually become a part of. They can play it, but they don't actually become a part of it. In this particular game, they actually do become a character in the game. And remember, it said that it's an occult game. One of the dangers of this thing is, being a role-playing game, is that it's played with the mind. How many know that the mind is a very fragile thing? And what happens is, in these role-playing games, I'm going to use the example of Dungeons and Dragons because TSR is the one that puts out all their material. The danger of Dungeons and Dragons, or any kind of role-playing game like this, is that it's played with the mind, and when played with the mind begins to lose that fine line with what's real and what's fantasy. And the more you get into the fantasy world, the more it seems real, and all of a sudden now you don't know what's real and what's not. In Dungeons and Dragons, this is a game played by three or four people. And what you do is you have one particular person that's the dungeon master, and he sets all the rules up for this thing. And then in your mind, you actually fight battles. You go through mazes, you go through dungeons, and you actually fight wars with evil wizards, dragons, demons, powerful satanic beings. It's all in the mind. And I mean, if you've got a vivid imagination, you can have one heck of a game. And what happens is that you can play this game for 10 to 12 years. Because the object is, as long as your character is alive, you're in the game. Once your character dies or gets killed in that particular game, you're out. So you can imagine that if a person loses touch with reality and now they've actually become that character, guess what? Anything that happens to that character now happens to them. And there's overwhelming evidence, psychiatrists and psychologists both tell us, there's overwhelming evidence showing that a lot of teenage suicides that are caused by Dungeons and Dragons are caused because the player has finally lost touch with reality. And what's happened to them now, they actually feel a psychic bond with that character. And so the character gets killed off, no longer in the game, you have no purpose. Because all your purpose was for the last 10 to 12 years was playing Dungeons and Dragons. So your character gets knocked off. Guess what? So do you. So let's go back to Magic the Gathering. Here's one of the cards. Yeah, isn't he cute? This is Cabal Ghoul. Now, you notice that there's counters up here. In other words, this stands for 2 points. And it says Cabal Ghoul. Now, in case you don't know what a ghoul is, it's a dead, rotting, decaying thing that's been in the ground and magically summoned back to life. So you have a walking, dead thing. And that's what a ghoul is. And in this particular thing, it says, at the end of each turn, put a 1+1 counter on Cabal Ghoul for each other creature that died during the turn and was not regenerated. In other words, you have cards that'll actually keep your character alive for a certain amount of time. Here's another interesting card, because it's called the All Hallows Eve card. Again, this is all in Magic. Magic the Gathering. By the way, there was a news clip that I read about 2 weeks ago that spoke of a young boy in Maine. I don't remember what the town was, but it was in Maine. And he came home one day and asked his mother about Magic the Gathering and said that the teacher had decided to use Magic the Gathering, this card game, as a new and exciting way to teach mathematics in school, in their class. And they even formed what was called a magic club, and that all the kids were part of this magic club. Well, the mother said, well, you're not going to become a part of that. You're not going to be in that. But one of the kids had given him one of the cards, and that card he showed to his mother, and that card was called Necromancer. And on that card, it showed spiritual beings actually being risen up out of the ground, out of their grave. And then he asked his mother, what does summon mean? And she said, why do you ask that? And she said, he told her, because all the kids on recess go outside on the school grounds, pick up huge sticks, wave them in the air, and say, spirits, enter me. True. This is All Hallows Eve. Again, 2 points symbolized by two skulls. Here's your demonic black cat. I guess it's a black cat. I've never seen anything look like that. There's your demon in the middle, jack-o'-lantern, full moon, and it says this card is called sorcery. Sorcery comes from the Greek word pharmakeia. It's where we get the word pharmaceutical. In occultism, it's witchcraft through drugs, sorcery. And it says put 2 counters on this card, remove a counter during your upkeep, and when you remove the last counter from All Hallows Eve, all players take all creatures from their graveyards and put them directly into play. Treat these creatures as though they were just summoned. You choose what order they come into play. Remember that, again, this is a role-playing game. This is called the Magician. I wonder why. Here you see the man kneeling, and look, he's forming with his hands the triangle. Right there. And he's kneeling in front of a flame. There are the crescent moons behind him. Over here can only be demons. Hellfire. All around here, and it's called the Magician. And these are collectible cards. And these are cards that one day your child may come home with, or may know of a student that has given him some of these cards. Now you will know what they are. So let's go back to Pokemon. Because now we've already established that the same company that puts out that game and puts out Dungeons and Dragons puts out cute little Pokemon. Isn't that interesting? Now, before we go any further, I want to see that if we as a group can agree on something. So I need little audience participation here to say yes or no. Okay? Are you into that? Okay. Listen to me carefully. If we examine the characters of this particular program, and they are the kind of role models that we want our kids to be watching. In other words, if this whole game, the characters of this game, the monsters, this whole premise of this thing actually goes to establish the kind of values, the kind of standards, and the kind of morals that we want our kids to have when they reach adulthood, that it's okay. In other words, if they actually help to establish the kind of morals, values, and standards that we want our children or our grandchildren to have when they get to be an adult, that it must be all right. Can we agree on that? Okay. So what we need to do is we need to examine and see what kind of role models we have in this game. Now, what we need to do then, everybody go, oh, again. Oh, I know, he's cute, isn't he? Little satanic tail. Up here is the Pokemon ball. Okay? That's this thing here. Okay? And inside of that, you catch the Pokemon. Let the camera get a view of that. That's the Pokemon ball, and you actually catch the monster inside of that thing and harness the power in there. And then you can call on that power to regenerate itself outside of that ball. And praise God, it turns into a bigger and better monster. Now, we're told that there are 150 species of these particular creatures on the face of the earth. And we're also told in the material that these pocket monsters are creatures that inhabit the world with humans. And that they can evolve and grow in bigger and better creatures. Now, the object of this game is got to catch them all. And they tell you that if you catch them all, you become a Pokemon master. Listen, parents, that word master will appeal to any child because they can become a somebody. They can become a master. And you know what? If you're the master of something, you don't need mom, you don't need dad, you don't need grandparents, you don't need aunts and uncles, you don't need school, and you probably don't even need a church because you're a master. You can become a god. That's the premise of what this has been teaching. You become the Pokemon master. That's the whole premise and the whole goal of this game. Now, this is the main character right here. He's called Ash Ketchum. Not Hal Ketchum, but Ash Ketchum. Okay? And again, it doesn't make any difference what I say. It's what their own material says. I'm going to tell you what they describe him as. Listen to this. An energetic and determined 10-year-old who's a little too competitive, and he's obsessed with catching all Pokemon and driven to become the world's foremost Pokemon master. And, you know, every time that your children watch this program, whether it's a video, whether it's a cartoon, whether it's a comic book, no matter what it is, they hear this mantra, this rap song that's played over again. And it says, I will travel across the land searching far and wide each Pokemon to understand the power that's inside. And then it's enchanted to them. Gotta catch them all. Over and over and over and over again. You know what it does? It fuels your child's craving for more cards, more books, more videos, more movies. It's designed to do that. That's what we call enchanting. Here's the next character. This is Misty. Look at this. Now, this is off of a comic book. This is actually a page of a comic book. But if this was actually clear, you'd see that that's a halter top. It stops right there. And she's got short shorts on. And you know she's got to be about the same age as what Ash is. Okay? And she's described as Ash's companion. And listen to what it says about her. She's headstrong and stubborn, constantly arguing with Ash. Typical woman. No, just kidding. Just kidding. God forgive me, all right. Frivolous spirit, that's what it was. And here's Brock over here in the corner. And Brock is by far the most hormonal because his fascination with the opposite sex many times gets him or the group in trouble. Well, then there's Pokemon trainer Gary. And Gary's not pictured in here. But Gary is a real self-centered jerk. He's vindictive and he's obnoxious. And then there are two characters, and one's called Jesse, and the other one's called James. And listen to what it says about them. It says, prepare for trouble, make it double. Jesse and James are an evil gang looking to steal rare Pokemon. Jesse and James are stuck up, fashion conscious, and you know what? In the program, they're also prone to cross-dressing. Now, if you don't know what that means, that means that if you feel like you're a woman in a man's body, you wear women's clothing. You dress like one. If you're a woman who feels manly, you wear men's underclothing and dress like one. Cross-dressing. Oh, what kind of role model would that be? Okay, now remember at the first, I think that's enough right here, because I think we've got a pretty well good establishment on this thing. Remember that I said that if the characters were the kind of role models that established the kind of values, standards, and morals that we wanted our kids to have when they got to be an adult, that this game or this particular thing is okay. Remember we said that? Okay, so let's examine what we got. Let's see. Headstrong, stubborn, quibbling, self-centered, vindictive, obnoxious, hormonal, sexually preoccupied, evil, thieving, cross-dressing jerks. I don't know about you, but I mean, even if I wasn't a Christian parent, I wouldn't want my kids to grow up with those kind of traits. Then we have to actually say that the characters of this game don't biblically stand up, do they? In other words, they don't represent the kind of values and standards we want our kids to have. And they're definitely not the role models we want our kids to be. But these are the characters that our children are identifying with. Day after day after day, playing this game, watching the cartoon, reading the books, looking at the videos. Now, we're also told that these actual beings have supernatural abilities. In other words, they can evolve and grow into bigger and better monsters. Now, this is a scene, actually this is a poster from the movie. And look here, this is Mew over here, M-E-U, he's kind of cute. And this is Mewtwo over here, complete with his satanic salute. And if you notice, that pose is always given with the left hand. That's significant. Remember the left hand path? And we're told that they get bigger and better. Of course, that's what we always want. Bigger and better monsters. That's what the world needs. And we're told that they get bigger and better through the use of energy. Now, a funny thing happened. Well, it actually wasn't funny, but an interesting thing happened when this movie, Pokemon, was actually first released in Japan. I want you to see it. This is from CNN. Look at this. Because this is very highly unusual. Japanese cartoon triggers seizures in hundreds of children. And look at this. This is Tokyo, December 17, 1997. This is when the movie was first actually released over in Japan. The bright flashing lights of a popular TV cartoon became a serious matter Tuesday evening when they triggered seizures in hundreds of Japanese children. In a national survey, the Tokyo Fire Department found that at least 618 children had suffered convulsions, vomiting, irritated eyes, and other symptoms after watching Pokemon. Japanese television network NHK reported that 111 people were still hospitalized Wednesday morning. And now spokesman Hiroshi Urimoto said that a later broadcast of the show, scheduled for 30 other stations nationwide, had been canceled and that an investigation was well underway. "We are shocked to hear many children were taken to hospitals," Urimoto said. "We will investigate thoroughly and consult with experts." And you know what they found? Not one of those children had a history of epilepsy. Now, you know, working in the mental health field for as long as I did, I can tell you that bright flashing lights will trigger off in occasion seizures and convulsions in kids or even adults that are prone to be epileptic. But not in 100 and so kids who have no seizure problem and no epileptic history. There's something unusual about that. And they went through, and it goes on further to say that they went through and even did CAT scans. And the whole premise was that at the end, they had to conclude that they don't know why it happened. Is that by coincidence? Or did something happen that they can't explain? Remember I said that they get their energy through energy balls. And here is a picture of little cute little Pikachu, and he's being energized by an energy ball. And now you notice he's not quite so cute anymore, and his little satanic tail is really erect. And now, parents, if you're not up on Pokemon, you need to be. And one of the things you can do is go out and buy the official Pokemon trading card game Player's Guide. And you can get this at any store that sells any of the Pokemon stuff. I mean anything. You can get it like at Toys R Us or any of those places that sell any of the Pokemon. And it says on the back of this, catch them all, then build an unbeatable tournament deck. And one of the things you can do is look through here because it shows every Pokemon in existence, and it tells you what their powers are, and it tells you how they get weak, and it tells you how they energize and what you need to energize them. But something very unusual is also in this book, and that is that they actually show the energy balls that is used to make these monsters bigger and better. I want you to see them. I hope you can see them from where I am. I'm going to hold it out here so hopefully you can see it. Look at the yellow. What do you see? Lightning bolt. Look here. All-seeing eye. Everybody see that? Up here is the clenched fist, symbol for rebellion, anarchy. Right down here is a powerful witchcraft symbol, where my finger is, powerful witchcraft symbol, and it's the symbol for fire. Down here is another powerful witchcraft symbol, actually a New Age symbol, they call New Age symbol for earth. Okay, which is a green leaf. And down at the bottom here, this blue ball down in here, is the symbol for energy of water. And water transforms into wind. Earth, wind, and fire, the three basic elements of all witchcraft. And I'm going to ask you, parents, grandparents, concerned aunt and uncles, friends, do you think they put that in there by coincidence? Do you think they just built this game, put these on there, and said, hey, let's just put those symbols on there. They look cool. Kids won't know what they are, but they'll like them because they look cool. Or did they put them on there because they know what the meaning of each one of those symbols is? And they want to desensitize our children to seeing those symbols so much that when they see them in other things, hey, no big deal. There is a devised plan going on for the battle of our children's minds. There's a war going on right now for the children because Satan wants them really bad. Who better to serve the Antichrist than the youth? And the whole object is to catch them while they're young. Remember the old, remember the Pokemon motto? Gotta catch them all. Who do you think feels that way? It's the enemy. Gotta catch them all. Gotta get them while they're young. Gotta induct satanic doctrine. Gotta put these symbols in their spirits. Gotta put these monsters in their heads. Gotta mess up their dreams. Gotta mess up their reality. Gotta break up the family. Have you ever tried to get talking to a child when he's into this game? It's impossible. They spend more time on this Pokemon. And you know what? It's amazing that your child can tell you every Pokemon in existence, even tell you where they get their power, what they do, and how they do it, but they can't tell you what you told them 5 minutes ago. They also can't tell you probably what they learned in school that day. And even worse than that, they can't quote you scripture. There's something wrong. And I'm talking to the men right now because, you know, men, we've been given an awesome task by God. We have nothing to say about it. You know why? God tells us that we're the priest of our homes. We are the ones who say, we are going to follow God. I don't care what anyone else does, but as for me and my family, we are going to serve the Lord. We are the ones who are supposed to say, this stuff is going to be allowed, and this stuff is out. And ladies, women of God, you've got an awesome task ahead too, because the Word of God says that you're to raise your children in the ways of the Lord. Not in the ways of these Pokemon, not in the ways of witchcraft or Satan worship, but in the ways of the Lord. Are we doing that? Or are we subtly giving in? This is a picture from one of the comic books. Look at this. Pokemon Psychic Surprise. Surprise, all right. Look at this. This creature right here is called Haunter. And I talked to three kids in three different cities who actually came up and told me that they were having bad dreams and that creature was in their dreams. Called Haunter. That makes sense. Haunt. Right up here is a creature that's not quite so cute now. This over here is not quite so cute. Little Pikachu down here, he's crying his eyes out. He's not cute, and even Ash doesn't look cute anymore. Psychic surprise. And you know, going back to those energy balls, I believe that those energy balls represent that the Pokemon get their power by supernatural occult ability. You saw the symbols. Remember, the material speak for itself. They give themselves away. And what made that even more evident was two cards. One was called Abra, and the other is called Kadabra. Abra, Kadabra. And that's an actual phrase. It's an actual name. Listen to this. Webster's Dictionary defines it as a word supposed to have magic powers and hints used in incantations on amulets, etc., a magic spell or formula. And on the Abra card, it says, using its ability to read minds, it will identify impending danger and teleport the user to safety. The Kadabra character has a pentagram on his forehead. And he has SSS across his chest. And it is the satanic SSS. And in my particular sect of Satanism, we didn't have it, but I ran into other groups that did. They had tattoos on the inside of their wrist, over their breasts, or on the inside of their thigh, and it was that same SSS. You know what it stands for? Satan's Solemn Servant. And also, the Kadabra character is always pictured on the card with his left hand giving the satanic salute. And again, I have to ask you, do you think that's on there by coincidence? Do you think they just made this game and said, hey, let's just throw that in there because it looks good? Let's just throw that in there because it makes it look a little more exciting. Or did they put that in there because they know exactly what it means and they want our children to get desensitized to it? They want our children to be able to look at that and actually at one day now, while they're identifying with their favorite Pokemon, reach up and go, hail Pokemon! And what are they actually hailing? Satan. Listen, our kids are carrying around these cards like they're magic symbols, and they are taught to believe that they can call on the powers of these cards anytime they want to. And I ask you, do you believe that our kids believe they have power? Or do you think that it's just nothing but talk? Because if they don't believe that it has power, why are we seeing time after time after time news clips about our kids beating each other up on school grounds, even stabbing each other over Pokemon cards? Look at this. Quebec teen stabbed at school over Pokemon cards. This was in Montreal. And this was a 12-year-old student that tried to help his younger brother after his younger brother had his Pokemon card deck stolen from him. And he went over to these young men to get the cards back, and one of the boys pulled out a 4-inch knife and stabbed him with it. Look at this. Boy attacks teacher over Pokemon. Here in Lakeland, Florida, there was a young boy who had a deck of Pokemon cards, and he was passing them around the class, and the woman teacher noticed that they were paying more attention to Pokemon than they were her. So she waited for the deck to get back to this young man, and then she walked over and grabbed that deck out of his hand. He got up and struck her dead in the face with his fists. And he got called in on the principal's carpet in the office, and they called for the parents. The parents came to pick him up, and you know what he told his father? They were trying to steal my powers. Our kids are taught to believe that these things actually have supernatural ability and that they can call on them anytime they want to because their material states that. In this book, it tells your child, you have the power at your fingertips, so use it. And that's what they're doing. This game is a war designed to attack our children's minds, their very character. And if it gets into our homes, it will wreck family life in one way, shape, or form. This stuff is nothing more than unadulterated witchcraft, and it's put in a child's form designed to attack the child and the parents and the entire family that this thing is associated with. That's exactly what it's designed to do, and that's what it does. Pokemon is a step to bigger and better things in the occult. And I have to wonder sometime when a grade school child is going to do what the Weeping Bell Razor Leaf Pokemon card says. It says this: it spits out poison powder to immobilize the enemy and then finishes the enemy with a spray of acid. And these cards cost anywhere from $7 to $9 per single pack. And there are report after report of children going into their parents' pocketbook and stealing money to go out and buy these cards. What is the purpose? What is the magic that's behind the whole game of Pokemon? I think by looking at it in that realm and looking at it the way that we've looked at it, I don't see it as being something that is beneficial to our children. I don't see it as being something that's going to help our family grow. And I sure don't see it as something that's going to help get the child established in the ways of the Lord. This is totally the opposite. Remember that the whole goal in all of these role-playing games, and especially in Pokemon, is to become the master.